अस्तु विश्वस्य खलौ प्रसीदता जायन्तु भूतानि शिवो विभूतिरा मनश्च भद्रं भजता अतोक्षते अविच्युतानो मतिरस्य हरिके May there be good fortune to our people and may all envious persons be peaceful. May all living entities become calm by practicing bhakti yoga. For by accepting devotional service, they will think of each other's welfare. Therefore, let us all engage in the service of the Supreme Transcendence, Lord Sri Krishna, and always remain absorbed in the heart. Quotation from Srimad Bhagavat Puran, 5th Canto, 18th Chapter, 9th Verse. We are all aware that due to the COVID-19 pandemic, our people presented uncertainty and anxiety as forced travel and tourism to take a back. As a result, the travel and tourism sector being amongst the most affected globally. Given the phase of restoration strategies being designed in different countries worldwide, there is no denying that the industry ambiguities are here to stay for a while. Industry experts are optimistic about faster recovery of demand for domestic travel. However, there is not much clarity on the resumption of international tourist travel like before. India has been well known for its cultural, historical, spiritual tourism connected to the Vedic wisdom and the diverse destinations. It has continued to offer the world varied travel experiences ranging from accessing wellness to savoring wildlife, from exploring archaeological locations to discovering mystical connections, discovering beaches and mountains, and much more. We believe that the present circumstances require us to rethink and relook at the India travel experience. The Indian tourism sector contributes over 5% of the country's GDP and directly or indirectly employs over 12% of the working population. Including a wide range of heavy industries, the COVID pandemic has crippled the Indian travel and industry tourism. The entire value chain linked to the business of tourism is expected to lose revenue in several crores. Research worldwide has already begun to measure the impact of the pandemic, which is not only economic, but which has also penetrated at the social and the cultural level. This has affected people's behavioral responses to the current situation, and this is at the very core of their thought process. Potential travelers will now be seeking much more than before while spending for a travel experience. This calls for the industry to look at long-term sustainable revival strategies in order to engage, connect, and reassure the traveler. With the central idea of collective sustainable resurgence centered around purposeful travel, Govardhan Eco Village presents a 3-day international travel trade conference called Reinventing the India Experience. Govardhan Eco Village is a project by the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, ISKCON. Governed by the principles of humility and sustainability and philanthropy, Govardhan Eco Village implements several rural development initiatives in many villages and has always endeavored to globally serve and propagate the benefits of India's age-old traditions for transformative change, including Ayurveda, yoga, and meditation. Located in the Palghar district of Maharashtra, Govardhan Eco Village is a model community implementing various sustainability initiatives and is working with the neighboring tribal villages for their sustainable development. Upholding its primary spiritual values, Govardhan Eco Village has also been awarded the United Nations World Tourism Organization Award in 2017 for its innovative initiative of ecotourism as a catalyst for rural development. This was also the first time that India has won this award from the United Nations in the NGO category. Govardhan Eco Village is also accredited to the United Nations Environment Programme, to the United Nations Economic and Social Council, ECOSOC, and United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, UNCCD. This three-day conference, in collaboration with Bhakti Vedanta Research Center, affiliated to Mumbai University, Tiger Trails, a World Responsible Tourism Awarding, and the THEAT project as knowledge partners. This symposium aims to come together for a united vision and a pioneering action to build resilience, from challenges to see perspectives for innovation for sustainable transformation of India's authentic travel experiences centered around wisdom and spiritual culture. The conference will take place on the 29th, 30th and 31st of October 2020. Ms. Meenakshi Sharma, Director General, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, has agreed to inaugurate the conference on the 29th October 2020. As we all move towards the new normal, this extraordinary period calls for a united effort and a harmonized approach to seek innovative and organic opportunities for reopening the sector. The restoration demands a new synchronized vision towards transformative steps for reimagining and reinventing the industry in a sustainable manner, for creating new possibilities in the fallout of the COVID-19 pandemic that has hit travel trade the hardest. At this three-day travel trade conference, Govardhan Eco Village and the organizers bring together industry leaders and experts to discuss and debate pioneering initiatives that step beyond the usual to reinvent the India experience. Through collaborative deliberation and intense introspection, this platform ultimately aims to lead by example, to set the stage and creating
the ministry's schemes with the state governments, local bodies, and also coordination with travel and trade organizations for promoting tourism within the state and the country. Ma'am Neelaji, we are truly, truly value her guidance throughout the planning and execution of this conference. I now request her to take over and moderate the inaugural session. Neelaji.
To all of you for this first digital tourism conference themed Reinventing the India Experience Towards New Normal, being organized by the Govardhan Eco Village and co-organized by Bhakti Vedanta Vidyapeeth Research Center, Tiger Trails, the D Project, and India Tourism Mumbai. Before we get started, I would like to express our gratitude and appreciation to all of you who generously helped us to put this event together, and also to those who are here to attend the conference. We couldn't have done this without your assistance and help. As we all know and has already been discussed several times, COVID-19 pandemic has thrown the business of travel and tourism and hospitality industry out of gear completely and globally. While countries are struggling to design revival strategies, uncertainty continues to linger throughout. It may take a few years for all of us to get back to the level that we left at before the pandemic hit us. But that doesn't stop us from working hard on this. Now it's time to take a fresh look at tourism resilience and jointly work on it. In this conference, we would be concentrating on how to move towards the new normal, the ways to handle hospitality and travel business, creating new experiences by keeping in view the restrictions, safety precautions, hygiene norms, and many more. This conference aims at calling for united and harmonized approach to seek innovative opportunities for reopening the sector. Therefore, the Govardhan Eco Village, along with co-organizers, have brought most experienced industry leaders and experts to discuss and debate groundbreaking initiatives that step beyond the usual to reinvent the India experience. Through these collaborative deliberations, this conference aims to lead by example, to set the stage in creating a manifesto for new normal of sustainable Indian travel and tourism business. Today and during the next 2 days, we will be learning about various initiatives, planned activities, and much more being undertaken by private sector, the government bodies, financial organizations to reboot the travel and hospitality industry. Without taking more time, I would now like to introduce our first two speakers of the session. Shri Gaurang Dasji. Shri Gaurang Dasji, the director of Govardhan Eco Village, is constantly working for social, ecological, and economic upliftment of the society. Govardhan Eco Village is the only NGO which has won the United Nations Award for Sustainable Tourism. Govardhan Eco Village recently got affiliated to United Nations Environment Assembly, which is world's highest level decision-making body on environment issues and also addresses critical environment issues. Gaurang Dasji is also an IGBC fellow from Indian Green Building Council and plays critical role in the leadership and organizational development of ISKCON. He is an inspirational speaker in TEDx and corporate bodies like Microsoft, Google, etc. Friends, our next speaker, our chief guest, who is going to deliver the inaugural address, is Srimati Meenakshi Sharma. Namaste, ma'am. Director General of Tourism, Government of India, Ministry of Tourism. Srimati Sharma is a 1988 batch officer of Indian Audit and Accounts Office Service, currently is the Director General of Tourism, and previously served as Additional DG Tourism in the Ministry of Tourism. She has also served as the Director General Professional Practices in Controller and Auditor General of India. She has the Master's in International Business and System Analysis from Delhi School of Economics. She had a fellowship award for General Accountability Officer of USA and has evaluated the reform process of World Health Organization, amongst many other multilateral organizations. Besides all this, I have had the privilege of working with her, a great officer. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being here. May I now request Gaurang Dasji to take over the screen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Neela ji, for your kind introduction, and welcome to Meenakshi ji for honoring us by your presence. It means a lot to us. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna describes A Brahma Bhavana Loka Punara Vartin Arjuna Mam Upetita Kaunte Punarjanma Vidyate. The Bhagavad Gita basically is presented by Lord Krishna in the form of a journey, travel of the soul through different experiences in different situations. So the innate quality of the soul is to hanker for newer and newer different experiences. And that has always remained eternally integral part of the soul's nature. And so we find that multiple kinds of destinations appear attractive to the soul seeking enjoyment in this world. Here, we find that tourism industry has grown by leaps and bounds over the last several decades. In a country like India, which is basically a hub of tremendous amount of culture and tradition, that from the 1000 AD, from at the period of the beginning of this millennium, when we had from 180 to 1000 AD, India's GDP contribution to the whole world was 35%. From 1000 AD to 1500 AD, it came down to around 28%. When the British started becoming more active in India, around 1800, it came down to 15%. by 1900, because of the very specific policies which the British had to cut down on our economic growth, the contribution of India's GDP to the world came down to 1%. And therefore, we find that since time immemorial, we have always been the leaders in the world for the major part of world's history with respect to commerce and economics. So India was an extremely flourishing economy. And even those who decided to come to India, they came initially as travelers, but then later became conquerors. But India has the wealth of tradition, culture, music, dance, drama, architecture, and such variety, which is just not seen anywhere in the whole world. And what is the most attractive aspect for travel is the more variety you add, the more travel becomes attractive. Therefore, we can see that a country like India, with its vast tradition, culture, and knowledge, has tremendous potential. At the same time, we also see that tourism as an industry can really bridge the gap in the employment ecosystem. Today, India has a population of 130 crore, out of which 27 crore are in the student system in the K-12, first to 12th standard. 3 crore are in the colleges. We find that only 12% of India's students who are in the schooling system, they are actually able to go into the college system. 88% of India's students, they drop out any point between KG to 12th standard. So 12th standard is known as the educational line of control. And we find that even amongst those who actually manage to get into college, the employment rates are such that 250 million youth are unemployed today. So with a workforce of 550 million who are actually employed, we find that 90 to 93% of that 550 million workforce are in the MSME sector, organized sector, and only 7 to 10% are in the actual corporate or government jobs. And so we see that in the last year, approximately the tourist inflow was 10 to 11 million with a population of approximately 1.3 billion. And a country like Northern Ireland with a population of 1 million gets a tourist of 4 million every year. This is all pre-COVID data. So we can see that India as a nation has such variety, such culture, such history, such tradition, such mystery. The amount of curiosity and experience which we can provide with respect to our ancient wisdom and tradition, and the unlimited quality of wisdom which we have, it is mind-boggling. What is required is we need to be able to churn all of that and present it in a manner which can be very easily accessed by people from across the whole world. And therefore, International Society for Krishna Consciousness, ISKCON, has been trying its level best to become the ambassadors for the message of Bhagavad Gita and the Vedic culture all over the world. And so we have experienced tremendous response, and we are very confident that all across India, many such opportunities are available if we simply take one step forward. I'm very grateful that all of you have joined together for this wonderful conference to reimagine, to reinvent, to rethink how we can actually increase and enhance travel considering the current COVID scenario. And therefore, this is a great opportunity for us to contemplate on the soft power which India has, our tradition, our values, our culture, our wisdom. Because as all of us know, we have to zoom in on our USP. What do we have as a nation which practically no other country has? If we list down those elements and really focus on making those elements as user-friendly, as accessible, as amazingly welcoming as possible, to that extent, we have a tremendous future once situation starts easing post-lockdown. Once again, thanks to each one of you and my hearty welcome to Meenakshi ji for joining us in spite of your busy schedule. Thank you.
Meenakshi ji, may I ask you to say a few words, your comments, please?
Namaskar. So I would like to thank Govardhan Eco Village and ISKCON, and specifically Mr. Gaurav Das, who has really given a very different perspective and however very needed perspective to the tourism. I have known about the initiative which Govardhan Eco Village has been taking, and it is one of those models which are Shashwat in some way. They were very, very relevant yesterday also, but today and tomorrow is something where it is something which is very much needed. So when we are, I would also like to thank all the organizers and Neela for inviting me to this particular project, because it also gives me some time to think and also ponder on the some newer aspects. When we are talking of reinventing tourism, we are talking of tourism in future and what can be the direction, what can governments do, what can industry do, and what other tourists can do. There are certain events in everybody's life, even in the life cycle of the civilization, which make us ponder, which make us stop and think. The challenge is this: do we have the patience to think? Do we have the right strategy to guide us? And do we have the strength to take it forward? I think the COVID crisis is one of those crises as far as the tourism is concerned. Of course, the economies, the world, we are talking of the nation's wealth, we are talking of the families, we are talking of the industries or the individuals. Everybody has been impacted one way or the other. We all have, in a way, life got paused for a while. But travel and tourism has actually been paused, which makes us think that even if the vaccine comes, even if all the visas, all the residue to go, the things are going to be different, and different in what fashion. As my esteemed earlier speaker has mentioned, that travel is something which is life. We always keep traveling, whether we are physically traveling or not. It is something which would happen. The only thing is, how will it happen? What are the challenges? How are we handling it today, and how should we handling it tomorrow? So I have certain thoughts and which I would like to discuss with you. So one of the things which is changed is that all of us have started thinking, all the citizens, all the travelers have started thinking that travel is precious. The kind of people we have been held in our houses, and even now I think a very large population of India and the world has not left their homes for a long time. So we all understand that how important it is to travel, but we are going to be, and when I say we, I'm talking as a citizen. I'm not talking as one of the person who belongs to the tourism industry per se. So how do we take care of the fear? How do we make it more pleasurable? And how do we say that it becomes sustainable? So I think the core words are going to be something which is satisfying, which is not satisfying only for the short term, because there might be a possibility that now travelers would like to travel in a fashion which is maybe for longer in duration, but a slow travel. It will also be something where they experience much more than just touching that destination. It has also have to have some other kind of an experience, whether we learn, whether we work with the community or similar thing. So in a short way, I can say that travel is going to be in a nature which is more responsible. I mean, responsible tourism is a very common word which is being used across various thought processes. But today, what we are looking at it is that it is responsibility towards your own health, about the health of the community which you travel, and about the whole environment. So when we say what is going to be a new normal, today when we say that whenever the travel starts, the good part is that the domestic tourism has already started. Even if we have some places which are still hot spots, India has been dealing with the crisis to the best of its abilities. People have started traveling by the road trips to a short distance at least. I'm told that the first weekend of October, because we had a long weekend, and even this current weekend starting tomorrow, it is impossible to get a good resort booked within the 200 kilometers of any big metropolis. What does it show? It shows that people want to travel, but they want to go to a particular kind of a place. People are not thronging to the normally what we thought are the hot spots. They want to go to a place where they can be in a quiet place, they can enjoy nature, they can relax and still feel the feeling they're outside their home, they are traveling. So this is something, it is not only for the time being. We feel, and after with a good interaction with the industry, that this is going to be the model. So what is this? Is that people want to be in a safe environment. So that is the first thing. Another thing is, we have realized that we all depend on each other. We knew it always. I mean, we do talk of Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam. We all know we belong with each other. We all know that we have there is a common soul which exists in among us. But that doesn't happen practically. But here we get to know that COVID has seen no discrimination. It is something which impacts everybody in an equal fashion, may impact. So I think there is something where there is a lot of empathy which might have come. And we should have learned from this experience that we need to coexist, we need to share each other's burden, we need to share the joys and the sorrows. So community involvement, this is something which is again one thing which should be the new normal. Another thing is, on a practical way, is that we need to be safe. Even if the vaccine comes, how much of it will provide the immunity? How will it impact one person differently from the other person? So better to be safe than sorry. So whether it's about the protocol, about distancing, about how to serve, how to keep hygiene. So for all that is very important. Towards this goal, Ministry of Tourism has already come out with a program called Sathi, along with the Quality Council of India, which is a kind of a self-certification thing that, okay, anybody who is providing a tourism service is aware of what needs to be taken care of, and they do take care of that. So that's again a very important issue of keeping the safety. Another thing which is very important for tourism, because sometimes tourism is seen as a kind of a product of luxury, that people want to travel only when they have the additional funds, or they can have the disposable income. But not true. In India, that's not true. And I think Mr. Gaurangdas explained it very clearly. It's not necessary that you want to do it only for the outwardly pleasure. In India, 60% of domestic tourism is about pilgrimage. Large number of population consider pilgrimage as a duty, not necessarily as a you know, spare activity. If you think in that fashion, pilgrimage tourism is very crucial. How do we make that experience enriching? Because if there is, it's not clean, it's not comfortable, it's difficult even to pray. So I think a lot of emphasis, I would say, should go for the experience on the pilgrimage tourism also, because that is also something which I think there will be a, you know, pent up demand for that kind of tourism also. So the new normal is going to be what? It is going to be something which is which gives you the experience of where are you going. It's comfortable, however it should be safe, it has to be sustainable, it should have some kind of empathy with the community you are going. So I think if we look it from that question, this crisis has given us the pause to think of all these things which were not on the high priority all the time. Even if you do not get a very, very large number of the international travelers, our domestic travelers are a huge number, and they also contribute to economy in a huge fashion. We need to think them as our valued customers and provide the same facility. So I think the new normal is more focus on domestic tourism, more focus on the lesser known destination, more focus on experiences. Because maybe I used to take 4 holidays in a year, I can now only take 2 because of the either the travel restrictions or the other logistics. But I may have a longer one. I would like to experience more. So I think that is going to be the other thing. So I'm very happy that this 3-day conference is being done, where you will have a chance to discuss the various models, and what better place than the Govardhan Eco Village to hold it this thing. So I wish it all the very best. I hope you come out with some good suggestion which we can, from the Ministry of Tourism, can share with others as best practices and also replicate. Thank you very much for inviting me here.
Meenakshi Sharma, thank you so much for that, for your valuable comment on the tourism industry and how it is going to play out in the near future. Thank you so much. Gaurav Adasti, thank you as well for your comments on sustainability and how it will pan out in the future. Thank you very much for joining us today for this inaugural session. And thank you so much. We have our next speaker. We have Mr. Rishikesh Mathurlal with us today. And I should introduce him briefly, and he would like to speak on a certain topic. Mr. Mathurlal is the chairman of Arvind Mathurlal Group, which mainly consists of 2 major publicly listed companies, Mathurlal Industries Limited and Nosen Limited. He is actively involved in many business associations like the Mill Owners Association Mumbai, Cotton Textile Export Promotion Council, Indian Institute of Management, Shri Bagubhai Mathurlal Polytechnic Mumbai. He is also associated with BAIF Developmental Research Foundation Pune as a trustee since 1992 and as chairman since 2012. He is a trustee of Shri Sadguru Seva Sangh Trust, Chitrakoot and Anandpur in MP. He is also the chairman of Bhakti Vedanta Hospital at Meera Road and is a board member of Govardhan Eco Village. Mr. Mathurlal would like to speak about Govardhan Eco Village, a destination for transforming hearts. So I request Mr. Mathurlal to please share his thoughts with us.
Thank you, Rishali. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible, sir. And Gauranga okay, Prabhu is also there with us here.
Yes. Well, first of all, let me start by saying that I was very happy to hear Mrs. Sharma, because she, in fact, spoke very much to the points that I also wanted to touch upon. And it is very heartening to know that such a senior government official also has similar views on what the future holds for India. Well, Govardhan Eco Village was actually started with a vision. It has been created over 12 years ago with the very purposes for which, in fact, we now see the need for attracting people in today's environment. So it is quite uncanny As Mr. Sharma mentioned, that people who will be looking for sustainability, pilgrimage tourism, you know, community involvement, are actually having will find all this and more at the Govardhan Eco Village. I'll just first quickly touch upon some of the features which are there, but I would like to mention some other points on the Govardhan Eco Village. But you know, we do have a very wonderful environment of 100 acres. We can accommodate more than 200 guests. The facilities are excellent. Special features are, of course, the food and the services. Very kind people, very warm. But one would say this is expected from any resort or from any destination. We also have a wonderful Ayurvedic and yoga training sessions, which is very successful. Also, we have one of the best dairies in the country. When I say one of the best, it means that we have some of the happiest cows there. And they are, and the reason is also that they are completely untied. At any time, they are always free to move. So when they're treated with compassion and love, we see the reciprocation is quite incredible to see how happy they are. But this is what I would say would every resort would mention, or every such retreat would expect, would be expected to provide. But what I find unique in the Vrindavan and the Govardhan Eco Village, we have some special features there. Like there is as we talk of the pilgrimage site, we have tried to create what we call the Vrindavan Forest, which is a 6-acre area, which is a exact replica of some of the major temples of Vrindavan, and which is of course a very high spot for Vaishnav tourists to go there, a replica of the Yamuna River, and the whole atmosphere really is transports you to the place of Vrindavan. But in addition to that, we have a lot of emphasis inside the inside the campus on relationships, on how we how not just guests are taken care of each other, but also there's a large community there. A couple of hundred people stay there because we have organic farming. We have also, we run a school there. It's a total situation there. But the underlying current to the whole Govardhan Eco Village is the emphasis on simplicity. See, the idea is to give an experience for people who are coming there, which is really something which can be transforming their lives. And we have many experiences, and I find that every time I go there, we are just, it's only a couple of hours from the city of Mumbai. But nevertheless, you know, we are so much caught up in our, with the complexities of life, the technologies, and the tensions that result orientation always pushes us to achieve. And then to find just a couple of hours away, a life where the stress is almost non-existent, very natural way of living, where we get a place where we can reflect on our own lives, where we can rediscover our the real values and virtues of simplicity, straightforwardness, where we can be happy among the clean air, freshness in the atmosphere, the clear waters, the farm, where we can take shelter in these communities. The happiness, where we also discover that happiness is not just in what we, the kind of material objects that we have, and certainly we do need to have a certain level, but more important is how we, what touches our heart and which leaves a lasting impression and doesn't cost anything. So these are the experiences which, and those who want to also help in, those who want to join into the, on the spiritual rejuvenation, they have ample opportunities. Those who want to engage in organic farming have the, they can grow fruits, flowers, vegetables, nuts, grains, etc. In addition, on the sustainability aspect, which Mrs. Sharma mentioned, that has been a core feature for us, because that has been the thrust in many ways, right from the time when we started. For instance, all the green buildings are green in the sense that they are made from, you know, improvised mud brick technology, which, unlike the commonly used baked bricks, these unfired bricks are, you know, they retain the mud's natural property of maintaining optimum temperature. So thus, these buildings would remain cool in hot weather and warm in cool weathers. And of course, they save a lot of energy and in heating and cooling systems. In addition, even on water conservation, you know, initially also there was a thorough study of the groundwater flow patterns, which was performed on the entire 100 acres. And then ideal locations were identified for extracting water. A facility was made to recharge the groundwater, and various rainwater harvesting structures have been created, including a huge one where almost 10 million liters rainwater harvesting pond is created in the campus, which serves the needs of the community. Even the treatment of the sewage processing, we have a unique technology which was developed with a chemical technology, chemical department of IIT Mumbai, which is actually patented, wherein it is the sewage is recycled and reused, and the organic waste constituents of the desirable of the sewage water, they're consumed, and simultaneously the water of desirable quality is produced, which is finally treated and used in farming, horticulture, etc. And on alternate energy also, alternative energy, we have a solar, large solar power panel. And our goal is to actually have that, you know, ultimately the whole community can be served by just the natural solar power, and then we reduce the dependence on fossil fuels. But to maintain all that, we also have a school of sustainability, what we call the Govardhan School of Sustainability, which actively educates everyone in this model by offering various programs. These are residential programs, typically between 2 to 12 weeks, where students from universities come and learn about the principles of sustainability. In fact, recently we had students from City University of New York, Princeton University, just a few months before the lockdown. In addition, global conferences on sustainability have been routinely been organized there in collaboration with corporates, NGOs, and the government. And another unique feature has been that right from the beginning, when 12 years ago, it was felt that when we what we achieve and what we benefit in terms of the environment, the natural resources, we should also share with our the needy and our neighbors. So over the last 10-12 years, we have now more than 3,000 families which have actually been helped by rural development initiatives, wherein they're all of them, their income levels have gone up between 4 and 5 times. And it's not just the income, but also it's the through my links with Bharti Agro Industries, that's BAIF, and NM Sadhguru, which are major, you know, NGOs who are in the integrated rural development programs. So we are focusing on farm-based livelihood enhancement of the tribal and rural families. So this has been initiated through the heart of GEV, the Govardhan Eco Village. So wherein whatever we have done for our water resource management and our conservation, we are also giving them, sharing with them, and also seeing that we manage and help them to stand on their own feet. So the not only the focus is to enhance the household incomes through agriculture, horticulture, you know, agroforestry, dairy, etc., but you know, how they can conserve water, how they can increase the cropping pattern, how they can improve their soil health, because, you know, soil health is the backbone of food and nutrition security, and the relationship with soil needs to be one of nurturing, not extractive. So the soil conservation and enrichment program, which BAIF had launched since inception, has now covered over 500,000 families. So we have taken benefit of that. Another unique feature has been the emphasis on women self-help groups, because, you know, they are, we can see they're really the backbone of the families in all respects, not just emotional, but also on the pragmatic side. So the self-help groups are also, you know, teaching the women, first, they now, many of them have learned to manage their own accounts, savings, but also the greenhouse farming, because for cultivation of vegetables, flowers, medical herbs, the processing of inputs like biopesticides and biofertilizers for organic farming. It has been taught to the ladies of the house. Even the production of seeds of improved varieties of crops and direct marketing is also been done by them. So the sustainability aspect of comes from various ways. One is, you know, tree planting, as you know, because it has a well-known buffering and resilience effects, and permanent tree cover protects and improves the soil. So that we have done a huge amount within our campus, but now we've also extended it to the farmers in that 50-60 kilometer radius. We have three medical centers which were set up in a collaboration with Lions Club, which treats almost 20,000 villagers in that span of 40-50 kilometers. So primarily the idea is to take everyone on our journey. To even the visitors are encouraged to join in on the voluntary program. Even our neighbors are, we would like to see them happy. So the happiness feeling, our vision is that not only should it remain with us, but our culture is that we extend it to all the near and dear ones. And we carry everyone who have whatever our resources are able to do so. So we have a large ambition to going in the future. But the most important aspect is that we go one step at a time. We maintain it through transparency, integrity, and a complete openness excuse me, with which we can, you know, gain credibility, reputation, and a love and affection which can, you know, sustain us going forward. So I would say Govardhan Eco Village is in its infancy. 12 years is, you know, you can say it's not even through its childhood for an institution. So we look for over the next few decades, and, you know, having Gaurang Das and others who have dedicated their lives with their intelligence and their integrity, you know, it's a very exciting project, which, you know, we would welcome everyone to come and actually experience whatever little I've been able to say about. And lastly, I'd like to thank you very much for the organizers to have invited me to give share my feelings. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Gaurangaji, would you want to say a few words here to Mr. Mafatlal?
Thank you so much, Mr. Mafatlal, for sharing your valuable time. You have been such a foundation for this project, and you and your family, especially your father, was instrumental in creating another such wonderful destination at Chitrakoot, which is now housed and welcoming thousands and thousands of tourists every year for spiritual pilgrimages. So we very much cherish the wonderful guidance which we received from you, and also the philanthropy which was actually shared within the villages in Kalgar district. We hope that many more corporates do get inspired by this combination of tourism, social inclusion, and developing villages within India, where we have more than 1.5 lakh villages available.
Thank you so much, Gaurangadasji and Mr. Mafatlal, for sharing your thoughts with us today. Govardhan Eco Village is truly, truly a wonderful, wonderful place. Yes, and all of you must visit it. It's a lovely, lovely place. So we'll move on to our next session now. And our next session, our theme for the day, actually, of the conference, is the Corona Impact and the New Normal. Our speaker for our next session is Mr. Praveen Padeshi. And the moderator for this session is Mr. Aditya Dhanvate. Aditya is, of course, a well-known naturalist and a conservationist, a safari operator, writer, nature tourism expert, and an eco-entrepreneur. He is constantly engaged with new eco-initiatives to improve the status of nature, rewild barren lands, and dedicated work on wildlife and for local communities across villages. As a consultant on sustainable tourism practices, he helps with development, planning, implementation, and marketing of new tourism destinations with an experience of about 500 plus destinations in over 40 countries. So that's huge, huge experience there. He's, of course, the vice president for the Vidarbha Tiger Research Foundation. It's a research group for conducting field studies on Indian wildlife, habitat management, and involving ethnic people in a nature conservation. He's an instructor at nature education camps conducted by VTRF as well. His projects have won the Weber Seaway Award for the top 10 police projects in the world. He is the partner at Meadows India Consulting with over 40 years of experience in environmental engineering services, including social impact assessment. So Aditya also co-owns the Tiger Trails Jungle Lodge, which is a wild getaway deep inside the tiger country. It has been created on the principles of responsible tourism practices, including habitat regeneration, groundwater harvesting, participation of local people, and use of trail cameras to monitor wildlife activities. So this work has won them many, many national and international awards, including the World Tourism Awards for the best in wildlife conservation. I would request Aditya to please introduce Mr. Praveen Pateshi, the topic that he's going to touch upon, and moderate the session as well. Aditya, over to you. You'll have to unmute yourself, Aditya.
Thank you, Roshali. Good evening, Pradeshi sir. Welcome to the session on international tourism and, you know, reinventing the Indian experience. Mr. Pradeshi is an Indian administrative service officer, and he's had huge amount of experience previously. He's been the commissioner for the Mumbai Municipal Corporation. He's been to the chief secretary in the chief minister's office of Maharashtra. He's been the forest secretary of Maharashtra. He's an avid wildlifer, a very enthusiastic photographer. And, you know, I would like to, without taking too much of his time, I would like to bring him on stage and let him speak about this session. Over to you, Mr. Pradeshi, sir.
Thank you, Aditya, and thank you for taking this excellent initiative. As you all know that tourism is really the worst hit industry because of the corona pandemic. And why it's especially harsh? Because tourism employs the maximum number of people in most of the developing countries. And it is these people who have informal jobs who are at the receiving end of the slowdown of tourism industry because of travel restrictions, social distancing, etc. So, of course, most countries are struggling with how to revive the tourism industry. I have a few ideas, and I was also looking at what some of the economies which are fully dependent on tourism, for example, Maldives or Spain or Italy or Kenya or Sri Lanka, they have a huge dependency on tourism, what they are doing, and then what we can do in India to make this a win-win for all. So I have a few slides and we can talk from that. So should I share my screen or would you be able to do it from that side?
Shivangi, can we have Mr. Pradeshi's
maybe let me see. I think I can share the screen from here. Okay, yeah, perfect. So, you know, this you can all see the screen now, no?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So though the COVID pandemic is a big challenge, but it's also an opportunity to build back tourism in a different way. Next. So one of the things that most of the countries are doing now who are heavily dependent on tourism is giving a safety certificate to give visitor confidence. So one of the ways to ensure the safety certification is staff testing. So ensuring that most of the staff are already tested and they do not have COVID. And now that the testing is becoming much more easier, this can be done. The other thing is to allowing international tourists who might be coming for just 1 or 2 days to continue to work from the tourist destination itself. So many of the Caribbean countries are doing that. So if somebody is stuck, and forget about being stuck, because now as most professionals are working from home, so they can combine tourism with work, which we never could do before. So you had to take leave to be visiting a country. Now you don't need to be on leave. So that's a big opportunity, isn't it? That you can be working daily, logging into your office, attending meetings, and yet being in a tourist destination where early morning, if it's a wildlife destination, you can go for a tourist safari, come back, and especially if you're working in a different time zone, you log in. So having good internet facilities, of course, a key here. But once you have that, then many countries have eased the restriction of work and people can stay for months together in tourist destinations and continue to work from there. So that's the thing. Now that requires what we call self-contained tourism facilities. So previously, there, or rather now, what tourism is that you visit a country, stay in a hotel just to park yourself there, but you visit the tourist sites within the city. Now that's going to be a bit more difficult. But if the tourist facility itself contains all the experience that the tourist is visiting for, then that center itself can work like a self-quarantining facility. So what do I mean? I'm going to talk about a model of nature conservancy, and I think Aditya will be able to sort of second that because he has a facility which can work very close to this model. Next. Yeah. So some of the things, of course, are standard restrictions which we need to, of course, follow, which is basically now we can have RT-PCR testing done beforehand. And if the facility itself advertises that we will take guests who are pre-tested, then, you know, the new people who are coming all can be assured that they are not. And of course, wearing masks, that is the most important thing. Actually, vaccine is not so important as wearing a mask is. I mean, it's more simpler and far more effective than the mask. And another thing, of course, it's that we can, till we have, we are out of this pandemic phase, we can focus on the younger tourists, because the younger tourists don't really face many problems. Even if they get COVID, the survival rate and coming out is very easy. Next. Okay, so now I'll come to what I wanted to speak about. I'll just talk about one particular model, which is nature conservancy-based tourism. And on that, it's very close to the Govardhan village model. What Swamiji was talking about just now, or Gangadas Ji, that you have a self-contained village where you have all Ayurvedic, organic, nature facilities. So that is for the organic, Ayurvedic type of facilities. But here I'm talking about to have a self-contained area, but which is totally wild and wilderness oriented. So this picture is taken from the national park from where Aditya works, which is Tadoba. But here you see the difference in this is that you have to stay in a resort and go into the park in a vehicle to see the prime site, which is, of course, people are out there to see tigers and other wildlife. So this is what the current model. Now, we think we can change that model and therefore enhance tourism even more. Next. So if you see from this particular thing, you can see that India has, though we are aiming to have 33% area under forest, we have very small area and the shortfall is huge. And the protected area is only 1.73%. So if we focus all our attention only on these tourism areas, these will become overcrowded and not give a very good experience. Next. Okay. Next. Yeah. So most of the parks have large areas outside the park area. This is the red line is the boundary of Tadoba National Park. But if you see the yellow spots, those are all farmlands. Now, people living in these farms, I was hearing Mafatlal Ji, though they are practicing agriculture, agriculture doesn't pay them anything. In fact, all these farmers suicide, failed agriculture. And, you know, I'm going to say something which all of you may not easily believe, but India has passed the production constraint. We have surpluses of wheat, rice, toor, oranges, mangoes, everything. But what we don't have surplus of is biodiversity, wilderness, water, forests. We are scarce on that. And now we have plentiful areas under cultivation, under all horticulture crops. And every year, the government has to procure huge amounts of wheat, rice, toor, and a lot of it goes waste because there are no buyers. On the other hand, we have two small areas under pure forests. And more urban people who earn a lot of money are wanting to spend it on being in the lap of nature. So can we combine the two? Can we move some unproductive farmland back to becoming forests and wilderness? Because forests and wilderness are not useless lands, as we were thinking previously. They are lands which give our country the water, the oxygen, and biodiversity, which enables us to survive forever. So these lands, which you can see the yellow ones, are under marginal cultivation. Most of their crops are taken away by wild pigs and they are in conflict, can they become a nature conservancy where tourists visit and they pay them much more than what they can cultivate, get from the cultivation of rice, but at the same time, the land is restored to its natural pristinity. Next. So we have this concept of conservancy. This can be community-owned conservancy. Social distance can be practiced there. People can come and stay for long. The staff can stay within the facility itself. So there is no going in, going and out. It can work like the Govardhan village, but devoted to natural wilderness only. Next. So the government of Maharashtra has already issued the GR when I was Secretary of Forest, and 80% of the jobs in such nature conservancy should be reserved for the local people only. And the constructed area should be limited to less than 10 to 15%. And if it's being managed locally, then the sewage water, everything, solid waste, everything should be treated. And the boundary of the land should not be fenced, because wildlife should be allowed to go freely. Only the residential area, small part, can be fenced, but the rest of the land should be merged with the surrounding wilderness. Next. So these are some of the guidelines that I've already repeated. Yeah, you can just go ahead. Next. Next. So this will lead to public-private partnerships, and it will change the model. Today, the model is people just have to book the safari to go into the park, and the park has very few entries. So tourism is already constrained. For example, if Aditya has 10 rooms, every day he probably can give guests of only 2 rooms to enter, because that's the number of vehicles, because the park area is small. But if we allow the surrounding areas to become wild, then his balance capacity can go to outside the park wilderness areas to see birds, to stay on machans, to sit up on water holes, to walk at night, all the activities which can take place outside the park area on private wilderness areas. Next. Next. Yeah, but of course, we need to ensure that the corridors are protected so that these areas also work for animals which are transiting through. Next. Now, we have been working on this model in Maharashtra. We already have the initiations of such nature conservancies in Aditya's area around Tadoba. Then we are also working on similar areas around Umraid. In northeast, in Arunachal Pradesh, Eagle's Nest is another example where local people got together, they converted their homes into homestay, and they don't allow hunting to take place so that the people who are visiting can see many species of hornbills. In Ladakh, the same strategy is being followed to see snow leopards. People have sold off their sheep because the sheep graze on the mountain slopes and the snow leopards can't be found. Once they sold off their sheep, the wild sheep, which is Bharal, have come back. Because of the Bharal, the snow leopards have come back. And because of the snow leopard, people don't need to cultivate that land. People who come to stay there to see the snow leopard pay many times more to stay in their homes and to watch the snow leopard. The advantage for us is that cultivating those precarious slopes, causing soil erosion, causing destruction of natural vegetation, versus people who just enjoy the beauty of the land because the land has become natural and pristine again. It's a win-win for nature, for wildlife, and for the local people's livelihoods. So we're trying to follow the same model by ensuring that the forest guest houses are outsourced to local people so that they directly benefit from wildlife tourism. And whatever money is earned from tourism by the forest department is rechanneled back to the local people through fuel subsidy, so that people don't have to cut fuel wood, they can have LPG connection. So most of the families around Tadoba, we have changed over from fuel wood to LPG connected gas. More than 1 lakh families were. And who was paying for their LPG connections? The tiger was paying. Because people who were paying to enter the park to see the tigers, the fees collected from that was given back to the local villages so that they could convert their fuel wood cooking into LPG based cooking. No more further destruction of forests. Next. So these are some of the examples where locally owned facilities can continue. Next. So I'll end with this, that ecotourism self-contained is a new normal, and we can proceed in this manner where despite COVID, people can stay in an area, enjoy the nature out there, and yet allow biodiversity to come back. So that's it from me.
Thank you, sir. It's been a very insightful conversation with you, and every time we get to learn something from you, even though we've worked with you for many years, there's always something new to learn from you. I have two questions for you, sir. So when you started this, there was a program called Janvan Yojana, which was basically Forest for People. And I feel that has helped communities around forest areas in a huge way. And I feel the Community Nature Conservancies is an extension of that very model that you have. My question is that when people, from source markets are looking to travel to wilderness areas, and now, post-pandemic, where people have been months sitting at home, do you think a multi-generational experience is what we can offer in these areas? Can we cater to all kinds of people through just not a wilderness experience, but a cultural experience around the communities as well?
Yes, of course. I mean, wilderness is just the comparative advantage of that area. So, you can go to any city, but if you go to Agra, then of course Taj Mahal is the peg. So when you go to an area which is in the outskirts of Tadoba, then of course wilderness is the peg on which you put it on. But that's not the only one, as you're saying. It should be multidimensional. So in the nature conservancy area itself, all sorts of rural crafts, rural cultural forms, in the evening you can have the folk music sessions. And combination of nature tourism with cultural tourism in surroundings which are in pristine nature is what everybody is ideally looking for. Unfortunately, in India, we are focused on just a few destinations. And then there becomes crowding on those destinations and they lose their value. So the main issue is how we can broaden it. Just like when we were facing food shortages in 1950s and we went for Green Revolution, and today now we are more or less surplus in most of the grains. Today we are facing shortages of biodiversity, of forest pristinity. We are not understanding it. And yet we are still in the mindset of the 50s and 60s where we are saying cultivate more, grow more. No, we need more forests, more wilderness, more green areas. Even for ensuring that our current levels of food production stay static, we can reduce the land under cultivation, bring it back to nature, because that will allow the recycling of biomass, water, soil, and protect our existing croplands. Now, once you do that, then what do you do here? How do you earn an income? So yes, nature experience is one, but as you are slightly saying, bringing in agro-processing and cultural art and cultural folk forms on these lands and allowing both domestic and international tourists to experience this. So this becomes the outward area or the hinterland for the cities. Today, people are doing a very negative thing. They live in small flats in Mumbai, but that's not enough. So they buy big farmhouses, the rich people, etc., outside. And you know, both ways, it's bad. Instead of that, if the local people continue to own the farmlands, because agriculture is not always viable, and then allow that farmland to be destinations for such people. So people don't have to buy their own private farmland and build a farmhouse. Instead, local people make this cultural agro nature tourism available to them. So this will bring a lot more money from urban areas back to rural areas and still preserve the biodiversity and the ecosystem in these areas.
Excellent, sir. So basically what you're saying is that you want to not only should we have a better biodiversity presence in our states and other states as well, but you also feel that the economic value of nature tourism can be spread across a wider landscape. And yes, that basically reinvigorates local communities.
Yes,
and also economies as well.
And it reinvigorates the entire natural resource base of India. Today, destruction of forests or reduction of the numbers of tigers is symbolic of the complete deterioration of soil, water, and air across India. Restoration of all of that, see, restoration of our rivers, just by putting up some anti-pollution control measures in some cities doesn't help. Similarly, restoration by putting more nitrogen fertilizer, our soil is not going to be rejuvenated. But if we have a balance where partly cultivated areas are in a mosaic of completely natural areas where forests, grasses, bees, birds live, then even the surrounding farmland is more productive. It leads less chemical fertilizer, and nature through the bees and the whole food chain allows a natural balance to take place. So for the long-term continuity of our agriculture itself, we need more forests and more natural water bodies. So this provides an income, but also ensures that our agrarian economy is safeguarded.
Thank you, sir. So looking at, you know, the lockdowns that are happening in Europe, do you think this is a continued phenomenon, or would this...
Can you repeat that last question? What did you say happening in Europe?
So some countries in Europe are now extending into a second lockdown.
Yeah.
UK, yeah. Germany. It's not lockdown, but it's still the conditions.
Yeah, restrictions, like, yes. Yeah.
Yes. So do you think this phase will continue for some time, maybe around the next quarter?
Yes. Yes, it will. It will continue for at least 2 to 3 months more until the vaccine comes or until the mortality impact. You see, in the first phase, the mortality from this disease was upwards of 3 to 4%. Now the global mortality has come down to 2.8%. In India, it's down to 1.5%. And as you know, human body gets a little bit more used to the virus, and also our treatment protocols, social distancing protocols become more behaviorally accepted by large numbers of people, then COVID will become like any other. There are hundreds of diseases still today prevailing. We haven't eliminated all the diseases, whether it is different types of flu or measles. We still have them. So this will be one of them. And the coming of the vaccine might lead to a real counter to it. But before the vaccine can come, I think social distancing and using of masks and ensuring that the people with comorbidities, that is, who have non-communicable diseases like diabetes, heart ailments, cancer, etc., they need to be protected. Fortunately, they are still a small percentage. The normal healthy people can be lot more outgoing with some precautions like social distancing and masks. So the economy can start on the backs of such people, while the people with comorbidities can take little more care in relation to social distancing.
So actually, the way we are doing much better than many of the Western economies are doing. And so I feel this is like a perception issue. Maybe we need to, highlight the fact that we are getting to a safe zone in India. Relatively.
So I have actually, I have written something about this, and hopefully it will come out next week. What I'm saying is that India's COVID mortality rate at 1.5% is nearly half the global average. The global average is 2.8% now. Then secondly, this is because we have a more broad-based health infrastructure, which includes the primary healthcare systems, and where other comorbidities like diabetes, chronic lung diseases, they are being controlled, if not very effectively, at least there is a measure of controlling them. So because of that, our mortality associated with COVID is much less. And we have a younger population. So that's another big advantage that we have. So with this, I think this is sufficient resources or inputs to start the economy, including tourism, back, because livelihoods and jobs are important, while continuing to take precautions like social distancing and wearing masks.
Right. So that's all we have time for today, sir. Thank you for your time. Thank you for joining us and sharing valuable insights. And we have to continue to be in touch with you in further. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. I'll just leave the studio now.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Pradeshi, for your thoughts. And that was a very, very interesting session. Thank you so much. We will have to quickly move on to our next session now. And our speaker for the next session is Mr. Kamlesh Barot. And the moderator is Ms. Smita Gulbari. Smita has over 30 years of pioneering experience in the travel and tourism industry. She has been associated with the most premium travel brands as a part of her past assignments, such as SOTC, Pony Travels, Thomas Cook, Royal Caribbean International, etc. Smita, she has also trained many young aspirants in the industry, including destination trainings to travel agents on behalf of tourism boards in India, Sri Lanka and Maldives, and professionals from MTDC, regional tour guides, immigration officers, tourism police, travel agents, etc. She is a certified skill trainer, a tourism hospitality sector skill counsel. She has been a member of the IATA Training and Development Institute, Partners a Global Advisory Board, and has been nominated to the Mentor Council for Hospitality, Tourism and Travel by Directorate General of Education and Training, Ministry of Labour and Employment, Government of India. She is a member of the Centre of Excellence, the School of Vocational Education, and serves on the Board of Studies of prestigious educational institutions. So I request Smitaji to please introduce Mr. Kamlesh Barot, who will speak on challenges of the hospitality industry, and to moderate the session. Smitaji, please take over.
Thank you. Thank you, Vrishali, for your kind words. Delighted to be here. Thank you for the initiative.
Yes.
Thank you for the initiative of organizing this international travel conference, reinventing the India experience towards a new normal virtually. Let me start our topic today. The onset of COVID-19 and subsequent travel restrictions, nationwide lockdown, has had an unprecedented impact on travel and hospitality industry. Lockdowns, social distancing, travel restrictions have led to closures of many restaurants, cafes, hotels are struggling for survival. The reopening has slowly begun and authorities have started to ease restrictions. Hospitality businesses are expected to make substantial changes to their operations in order to ensure employees and customers' health and safety. Enhancing customers' willingness to patronize their business is also very important. The industry is also working together with the government authorities in the true spirit of hospitality by making hotel rooms available for hospital employees and serving as quarantine facilities, with some of these hotels providing rooms for the Vande Bharat mission. The industry has been hit hard with a decline in occupancy, average room rates, revenues, and operational margins. Hospitality sector's revenue loss is estimated at almost 90,000 crore in 2020. Let's hear from Mr. Kamlesh Barot ji, the doyen of hospitality, our speaker for this segment, Challenges of the Hospitality Sector. Namaste and good evening. Kamlesh ji is the director of Y Hospitality Private Limited and Barot Hotels Private Limited, holding award-winning sub-brands Revival, consisting a chain of hotels, restaurants, clubs, and catering, both owned as well as franchised. Starting in 1947 from Crawford Market, today has spread across India, Dubai, Bangkok, and upcoming in USA. He has collaborated in early 2020 with the Ajmera Group as director hospitality with his brothers. Kamlesh ji was the president FHRAI, the apex body of hospitality for India for the year 2011 and 12, and the Hotel and Restaurant Association Western India for 2010-12. He has been the co-chairman of the IMC Tourism Committee. He was the founder partner of Stir Academy for Bartending at Revival. He was nominated to the HRD committee of CII, where he initiated the National Hunar Se Rozgar Skill Development Program and was on the Information Technology Committee of FICCI through the association. He contributes to newsletters, industry magazines, and media. He's a visiting faculty for many catering colleges. He's a speaker for many symposiums, seminars, conventions relating to hotel and restaurant industry. He has drafted the draft tourism policy for Gujarat and Maharashtra. He has been awarded the Young Restaurant Entrepreneur for the year 2004 and has been also on the course committee for hotel management, board of technical education Maharashtra, ad hoc board of studies for University of Mumbai, Dadar Catering College, and a trustee of the HRAWI Scholarship Trust. Good evening again, Kamlesh ji.
Good evening, Smita. Thank you for your kind words, and I really look forward to contributing something that can be taken back for our industry.
So, Kamlesh ji,
discussed yesterday, ma'am, is we will not get into a speech lecture kind of a thing, and we'll take the format of question answers where you will be asking questions and I'll be putting forth the answer so that it becomes a little more interesting than a boring 25-minute lecture.
Yes. So let's start. Could you highlight the major challenges the hospitality industry has faced post the COVID lockdown, given your FHRAI, background?
The major challenge that this industry has faced is about gaining back the confidence of the guest, our customer, and we call our customers as guests in hotels and restaurants. So that confidence building is an exercise which will take pretty long for the guests to come back to the hotels, come back to the resorts, come back to the restaurants. And this exercise is something which will not only be coming to an end once the vaccine is in, but is going to be there because of these kind of uncertain calamities that keep haunting our industry. Besides the guest confidence, what operationally our hoteliers and restaurateurs today face is the issue about capital. And this has more so come about because of the shortage that has been augured because of these 7 months of lockdown. And right now also, if you notice, the industry is only 30% participative. Mm. The rest of them are still shut. A lot of our properties are rented and leased premises, and therefore this capital expenditure that is always on a shortage because of the operations going into the red. Rent and lease payments are something which carry a default, and therefore it becomes a overriding challenge for the industry to try and commit to the rents that have been pre-COVID agreements, not taking the force majeure clause and the COVID pandemic calamities into these agreements is a major challenge. The other challenge is about the salaries that have to be paid when there are no sales either for the rooms or the restaurants. And as we know that this is a very capital intensive and a labor intensive industry, the salaries for all our team members have to keep going. And as the commitment goes, the industry doesn't like to retrench its staff, its employees. But the challenge is then to meet up with these salaries which were ongoing, and more participatively, our team members have forthcome and they have taken a cut in their salaries. So that comes as a little bit of relief. Even the suppliers, the vendors that we have for all our food and non-food supplies have their backlogs of these 6-7 months that the lockdown has been for this industry. And then the moment a restaurant or a hotel has to start back, the vendors' backlogs have to be cleared, which brings up a drain on the capital. The efficiency of manpower today can only be more skill trained and more SOP driven when there is a reverse exodus happening, where we had a lot of our team members leave from the hotels and the restaurants and go back to their hometowns. This has created a challenge today for operations to start with, because the manpower who had left the organizations have to come back and work in these tiring conditions and stricter SOPs. We have issues about MICE not happening, and MICE means the conventions, meetings, incentives, exhibitions. This is the segment that gives us business in the business hotels of the cities, besides the luxury resorts and the coastal area hotels and outlets, which are having weekend business in these days. The challenge is to have that same business that was there pre-COVID in hotels which are in the business cities, because the international traffic has come to a standstill. We have issues with the rooms being taken up by the Bombay Municipal Corporation for the patients, and there are certain hiccups about those payments which have to be made by the municipal corporation to these hotels which were used by these patients. Though with our dialogue recently with HRAWI and the commissioners, we've been able to get certain relaxations for property tax, but the challenge is to get that same relaxation for the entire properties across the board in the hotel and the restaurant segment. We have issues about the food service aggregators, which are the Zomatos and the Swiggies of the kinds who deliver this food at home. Their commissions are today biting the thin wafer margins which are left back after operations. So also for the rooms, where online travel agents are doing about 60-70% of the business in good hotels, the commissions that they charge range anywhere between 20-40%, and that itself is a challenge today to meet up with those kind of fees to continue doing business in the food and the hospitality segment. The incentives that either the industry used to have earlier from the various government authorities have still not got away from the stigma of linking them with the stars, and therefore if it's a five-star property, only then certain incentives are met or certain taxes are levied, and that takes away from the entire incentive for the industry to be in the organized sector and remain on the stars, and therefore FHRA has started its own way of calibrating and classifying hotels under the IHQS. So with us having these challenges, it's the fear of the unknown for the industry to know tomorrow what would happen. How would the finance minister announce any kind of SOPs like the recent leave travel concession that were allowed for the government employees to not only travel but use that entire allowance for white goods, and that takes away the entire tourism perspective that is possible with the government employees spending their leave travel allowance on travel medium. One challenge also is about the open spaces, because when only 33% of the property is allowed to open, the space for accommodating all the pent-up demand restaurant customers is nowhere to seat, because a lot of these seats have been blocked because of the usage restrictions. If the government looks forward to allowing this open spaces to be used for service of food and beverage, it allows the industry to augment a little more sales. Though the challenge today that a customer perceives when he visits a hotel or a restaurant is missing that visible smile, because it's covered with a mask where the team is not able to portray the right kind of welcoming attitude expected out of this hospitality industry. So these are the few challenges that we are facing today.
How about in your organization, you know, how are you dealing with, and what initiatives have you been taking?
In our organizations, we've been able to at least put the three main parameters that are required to do service of hospitality with rooms as well as food, which is the mask, the sanitization of the hands, and the social distancing. These three are the keys to have COVID-friendly, COVID-ready service staff to bring food and give accommodation to our guests. PPEs are the basics of today, and they are there to stay till the vaccine is on. So therefore, adhering to all the SOPs that our association, FHRA, has been able to roll out, as well as the SOPs rolled out by the MHA, the Home Ministry, and the Department of Tourism have all been adhered to at our organizations, besides attending webinars which we've been conducting at the association and trying to bring in the trust of our customers. This is something which we entail in our organizations. But for an industry at large, how our restaurants and hotels are meeting up with this challenge is at times discussing with their landlords about how best can these rents be renegotiated. At the association level, we try to do a lot of liaison work with the ministries and the secretaries to try and bring in a little more relaxation for the industry, like bringing in the corpus that's lying with the ESIC to pay the salaries for the ESIC covered employees in the organizations, or meet up with the authorities and try to get the payments released for the industry for usage of these rooms for the patients when the hospitals were full. We have a lot of our appeals going on to the vendors for relaxing the bit of credit more to this industry. We have been dealing with a lot of tourism promotion activities, and therefore when you see these international bubbles coming about, they are more out of an exercise where we make sure that the government is able to bring in the tourists from at least stranded places with the Vande Bharat scheme, but also to allow all those traffic movers which were leaving the country and going outside. Now that was a 26 million tourists which was leaving the country and visiting foreign lands are all now going to be staying back in the country, at least for the time being, and create business for us. We are looking at opening our lawns and other places where a lot of MICE can happen, a lot of engagements with social connects can happen. These are the initiatives that we've been trying to bring about and bring the industry back onto the toes. Unfortunately, if you are tracking the kind of uproar that is right now heard in the US, the restaurants are crying hoarse to the government and saying, please don't stop the payments that you are making for our salaries from the government treasury, which was the second dole which was being rolled out. While we over here in the Indian hotel industry are never got any kind of a sob coming in from the government on finance or on relaxations. And that's where the comparison between foreign industry veterans and industry people who are connected in India have to face because of this support that is lacking from the government. We have a lot of issues right now also going on with our aggregators, with our OTA. So these are things which we are trying to address at our personal levels in the industry.
Kamlesh ji, namaste. I think there is a little technical hitch. Smita has lost her audio. Kamlesh ji, wonderful that we've got such insight from you. Just a last word on FSSAI restrictions. Are they going to be stringent? Is the industry going to work on it and has already worked on it? How is it going?
We, in fact, are having a lot of FSSAI interactions with FHRAI and the FSSAI when the act was put in and was being replaced with FDA. And this was way back in 2010 when the act was coming into play. We have got FSSAI sitting down with FHRAI and drafting the entire act all over again after the inputs from FICCI went astray. We have come back to a stage where in 2012 we had across the country rolled out the entire FHRI, FSSAI, FOSTAC programs. And we have restarted that now with COVID online virtually and gone all over the place with the FSSAI trainings. We have from FHRI also started the FOSTAC program as well as the desktop audit program, where our agency from FHRI affiliation is able to go to every hotel, every restaurant, do a systematic audit and come back to the property with a certificate to say, yes, you're COVID ready and you are maintaining all the SOPs that are required to be in place.
I think this exercise is definitely going to give or help the confidence building in your clients and people who want to visit hotels and restaurants. One last one, Kamleshji, because our next speaker is already ready. How is the confidence for smaller hotels or smaller properties, the non-branded hotels, going to get into the public mind? How are you? Are you trying to, or are you working on that? So that these homestays, which are being promoted by state governments and the central government, or the smaller resorts or the boutique resorts, how are you going to handle that?
Unfortunately, ma'am, it has always been the endeavor of the government, and especially so with the existing central government, that bed and breakfast has been promoted. But we as the industry have always been pushing this across to the government, saying this is not really the kind of support that this industry requires, because the entire licensing, the entire security angle is gone for a toss. These bed and breakfasts are actually only portraying themselves to be six extra rooms available with the owner trying to run the entire setup. But for a fact, there are a lot of these unorganized sector players who, with the support of the OTAs, are trying to get the entire business from the organized hotel industry into their unorganized trade of the Airbnbs and the bed and breakfast. And we've been fighting tooth and nail. Our customers are in for surprise when they will be going to these unorganized places and find for themselves that there are no buffets and they can't do their self buffet service, or the food comes pre-plated to them, or they can't enjoy the food along with their families, or the room has to be quarantined before it is allowed to check in and check out one after the other. So these are the issues which are today going to be faced by one and all in this industry. We are able to only hold fort for a little while to hold on with this kind of backlash from the unorganized sector coming on this industry. So we would only pray that the government does not promote this backdoor entry of the unorganized sector over our organized players and try to bring in more semblance of business for us. It's really difficult for a soft target industry to be classified in a way that we are trying to get out of the red, come onto a break even, and then we are hit by these kind of backlashes.
True. I mean, there is a problem there also. Thank you, Kamleshji. You were wonderful. I think we've got the perspective that what happened with the industry and what's going to happen with the industry. So we all pray that the tourism and hospitality industry starts rocking again and as soon as possible. Thank you so much. So grateful for your coming here. Thank you. So we are back here again with our next speaker. Next speaker is Mr. Yuvraj Padole. Yuvraj Padole is the Deputy Director with the Madhya Pradesh Tourism Board, which was set up in 2017. And since its inception, Yuvraji has been with the board. But before that, he has been with the Madhya Pradesh Tourism Department for more than 30 years. And he is the person who is handling the events and the publicity and promotions for Madhya Pradesh Tourism. I'm sure some of us, or maybe most of us, must have visited Madhya Pradesh at some time or the other. Madhya Pradesh tourism is one of the rocking states, and it has so much variety to offer to tourists. So we are lucky that Yuvraji is here, who has had the exposure within India, outside India, and who has been promoting Madhya Pradesh continuously. I remember him, my interaction with him, which goes back to 80s. So we have almost worked together for on many events. Yuvraji, welcome to this session. And we would like to listen to you from on what Madhya Pradesh government, which is very, very proactive in tourism, what Madhya Pradesh tourism has done, what it has been, everybody has been hit badly. How has the setback taken by the state government and what challenges are there for you? And how are you are likely to overcome these challenges? Thank you.
Namaskar. Aaj is वेबिनार में इस इवेंट के आयोजन के लिए मैं सबको धन्यवाद देता हूं और मुझे यहां बुलाने के लिए विशेष रूप से लाड मैडम का आभार. नाउ मध्य प्रदेश एज वी ऑल नो इज द हार्ट ऑफ इनक्रेडिबल इंडिया एंड व्हेन वी से द हार्ट ऑफ इनक्रेडिबल इंडिया वी रियली मीन इट. एज वी ऑल नो द state is surrounded by five great states and geographically we are exactly at the center of the country and that becomes our advantage. So in cashing this geographical location at this pandemic time, we have done some preparations or preparedness for the state post COVID-19. So I have been watching great speakers speaking here and everyone has very rightly and focused way they have discussed about the situation, which is really unbelievable, and we have never thought of this kind of situation will come to tourism industry, and all of a sudden we have been taken aback. But whatever has been we have faced is the days are gone now, and let's forget those things and move ahead with optimism and with what best we can do to offer our guests, people who are coming to the state to visit our great wildlife tourism products, heritage, culture, and so many other things which we have to offer them. Well, it all started from February, March, and then that was actually the season for the state. And as we all know that we promote wildlife tourism to the great extent, and that was the time when we had many cancellations for our national parks, and it was really a bad time for all of us. But we thought not to give up. So we met all the stakeholders of Madhya Pradesh tourism. We invited them for a discussion. Many of them, they came and we had 3-4 rounds of discussion, which was very, very fruitful. And during that discussion, we tried to understand and we tried to assess the losses. We tried to understand what is their problem and what they actually want. In order to compile those suggestions and their experiences, their kind of demands, I should say, and to forward it to the appropriate departments in the government to consider some kind of relief or bailout packages or concessions or whatever government in its capacity can offer to give a helping hand to our stakeholders. So that was the series of discussions and webinars we had for three, four months. And then came the monsoon. We thought, let's go ahead and start something which will actually generate a kind of enthusiasm, kind of curiosity, and also we make them aware about what we have to offer them. So we started with Buffer Mein Safar. Actually, we all know that the monsoon is the closing time for our national parks, but core area is closed, but buffer zone, we keep it open for tourists. So some kind of activities going on in buffer area. So we tried to create some kind of social media impacts, some posts, some small print media releases also, in order to keep people aware and awake. But as we all know, the time was really bad and everybody was disturbed and depressed. People wanted to know क्या होगा, कब होगा, कब खुलेगा, कैसे होगा. सो वी वेयर हैंड होल्डिंग देम एंड देन वी स्टार्टेड अ न्यू कैंपेन विद सोशल मीडिया, इंतजार आपका. एंड बिफोर दैट वी स्टार्टेड प्रिपेयरिंग आवरसेल्व्स. So, Government of India, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India Health Department, Ministry of Health, they all started sending the guidelines and SOPs also. We circulated amongst our 67 plus MPSCTC hotels, and we circulated to our stakeholders as well. We requested them to get ready for the next coming season, which starts from October. So, and then we, in order to gain the confidence of our stakeholders also, we invited them for discussions. We told them how to get ready for the coming season, all kind of these social distancing and all these norms, fumigation and sanitation and room preparedness, which Marwar sir has already explained everything. So, and also, we with the district administration, we tried to provide them emergency medical services in case if someone is in need of that. Sarthak is an app. We started that in the state for immediate medical assistance. So by doing all these things, we created a kind of confidence amongst the stakeholders, among the failures, among travel fraternities, and everyone. Well, the next step was to prepare some kind of fixed itineraries. So our managing director has instructed us to prepare some small road tour itineraries, because we knew that domestic tourism will start first and people will start with small steps in nearby tourism. Dhoni sir has given us an award, Ask Pass Tourism. So we exactly followed that Ask Pass Tourism preparations, and we coined some itineraries, intrastate and interstate both. As I said, we are surrounded by five great states, and those are our source markets also as far as domestic tourism is concerned. So we found that if a person from say Nagpur wants to visit Madhya Pradesh, Panj or Kanha, it is very easy for him to go by road. The same is from Raipur, same is from Ahmedabad side, from Gujarat side, from Lucknow side, from UP, this thing. And people, we circulated all these itineraries to our travel agents, tour operators of those states, and through our marketing offices, through other sources, we made these itineraries available to all of them. And it gave them a kind of a confidence. People started coming. They started sending us the inquiries, how to go, what to do. So we offered them attractive discounts also. We offered them all-inclusive packages also. And we told them, if you need any kind of assistance as far as transport is concerned or anything, be assured we have everything in place and we'll help you with our marketing offices in other states. We have wide network of our own marketing offices in all these states. So that is again an advantage for Madhya Pradesh, that we have our own offices and people keep on meeting with them and interacting with them. So these challenges we had to face, and then came October, the month where all the national parks are reopened, all the monuments, all kind of resorts, hotels are reopened now. With, of course, we are following all the guidelines, all the SOPs, and all the kind of norms of the government and Ministry of Health. Now, we have seen a comeback. Guests are coming back. Now Diwali is approaching. We are having good booking for Diwali, and for then will come the New Year, Christmas vacations. So, doing all these things, basically what we have done, we tried to with the changing trends in tourism, we tried to change something. Because Madhya Pradesh, as we all know, is one of the largest state as far as area is concerned. So we don't have any problem of social distancing. We don't have any problem of congestion. We don't have any other problems. So what we have done is we have promoted experiential tourism. We are now promoting tourism. Experience the home stays, ground stays, farm stays, and all these kind of things. And enjoy local cuisine, local, kind of stories. People are there to very enthusiastically, they'll tell you about a particular place in that area, and they take you along with you to a temple, to a riverside, or to a jungle. So a different kind of tourism where you don't have to worry about any kind of infection or all these things. And people are coming. People have taken it with great enthusiasm. They are ready to come. They are asking how to go, where to go, and how they can enjoy all these things. So what we have tried to do is vocal for local. Local things we are promoting. We are promoting local cuisine, local recipes, local kind of folk dances, arts, handicrafts, everything. And people are taking it with great enthusiasm. They are asking us, okay, we have never thought that this is available there. And since we have a very good road network within the state, 65,000 kilometers of road network is in the state, very good roads. So one can travel with his own car, or he can hire a transport from a transport operator. That is also fully sanitized and all these things. We follow all the rules and regulations. So Neelaji, we are optimistic. We think that this season will be a good season for us. And it will pick up for us. Yes.
True. Yuvraji, wonderful efforts, Madhya Pradesh Tourism, as always. I mean, they have been really pioneer in many, many ways in promotion of domestic tourism, very particularly domestic tourism. And you have variety of tourism product. Of course, your main product is wildlife, which is your main USP. But besides that, you have monuments, you have natural sites that you have developed, the state tourism has developed recently. There are many countries or other cities which are promoting their own cities now. As you said, vocal for local, that is the mainstay. But are you doing some specific thing, like you have the three most cleanest cities of Swachhata Sarvekshan in the country? Are you taking advantage of these things and promoting these city tourisms, like, you know, travel within the city, explore your own city? Does MP Tourism have something like that?
Yes. We are very much into it, and we are promoting all these cities. And as you know, we have three UNESCO World Heritage Sites also, and cities like Mandu and Orcha, not big cities, but destinations. They have been shortlisted for UNESCO to become UNESCO World Heritage Sites. Indore is a place which we have developed for food tourism. So food is a very essential element, we all know. And we have curated a food tourism, food trail in Indore, which Sarafa Bazaar is a place which everyone knows now. Whosoever goes to Indore or Mandu or nearby places wants to be, to stay in Indore one extra day just to experience that food bazaar or Sarafa Bazaar experience. In the night, in the evening, it starts and it goes on till midnight or late hours. So these kind of things, if you go to Gwalior and nearby places, Gwalior we are promoting as a city of music. So this is again a thing. Khajuraho we all know, Mandu we all know, city of joy. And recently we had international event in Orcha to establish Orcha as a tourism product on international scenario. And that was just before the lockdown. That was before Holi, first week of March, we had it for the first time. And it was an integrated effort of the government of Madhya Pradesh to develop everything. As a destination, we tried to present it to the world, because it is very close to our Golden Triangle. Actually, the objective is to stretch that Golden Triangle and involve Orcha also in that, so that a person who is free in Agra can easily come to Gwalior and to Orcha. And it is very well connected from Delhi, this thing. And he can then go to Khajuraho. Khajuraho has its international airport now. So all these things we are promoting as per the, and as you said very rightly, these destinations are being promoted on activity-based destinations. So some of the other activities are there. And we also have, very interestingly, we have also developed a new concept, which is known as active holiday concept. So okay. Under this active holiday concept, we have just tried to curate some kind of activities for everyone in the family.
That's
suppose a family, is there in Pachmadi in case, and my parents, myself, my wife and my kids. So all of them should have something or the other activity to involve themselves.
It's a family vacation. Yeah.
It's a family vacation. So all these things we are promoting. As I said, we have started some new activities in the buffer area of the national park. So you are not only tiger-centric wildlife tourism. You're not only focused on tiger sighting, but you can also go for trekking, you go for bird watching, go for hiking, for camping, for so many other activities you can do in the buffer area of the park.
That's a great thing to know, because there are amongst our audience, there will be a lot of people who are looking for such kind of opportunities to go out. I mean, now people are really pent up sitting at home and want to move out. And your particular strategy of giving them the nature, when they come out, you are giving them the nature to explore. That's a great thing to do. One last question. When a tourist is traveling within Madhya Pradesh, what are the formalities? What is that? Are you insisting on a COVID negative test certificate or any such thing?
Well, we are not insisting on having such kind of COVID negative certificates to every tourist. But we do want to ascertain that they don't have any kind of problems pertaining to this particular disease or something. So if they are happily submitting the certificates, they are welcome. If they don't have a certificate, we just go thermal check and other things which are mandatory for every tourist when they arrive to the resort before checking in. We do all these formalities with them, and then they also cooperate. They happily tell us in case if they have. Because nowadays, you never know if there are some asymptomatic people.
So
ask them and cooperate. Yes.
So there is an ease of travel as well. I mean, it's just not that you're not binding them with all these kind of restrictions or anything. But people should be they should have the self restrictions on them and then come out. So wonderful. Exactly. Listening to you, listening to your perspective on state tourism's efforts that they are taking, and wonderful acronyms you always come out with for promoting Madhya Pradesh tourism. A great product. Thank you so much, Padoleji, that you have been with us today. And definitely, we look forward to more such sessions with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vera, for inviting me and providing the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So I hand over the screen to Aditya, who is now taking us to the next session of panel discussion. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yes, Aditya, I think you can proceed with the next session.
Yes. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this session on learning, about coronavirus and, the way forward for the industry. I'd like to welcome three industry leaders for this session. We have Mr. Faraz Jamal. He's probably one of the most senior, veteran hoteliers in India right now. A legend in the industry, phenomenal network. Massive credibility, and probably nobody can run a big inventory hotel like he can. He's now currently a group advisor for Raheja Hospitality and Hiranandari Group. And previously, he's been the senior vice president of the Taj, also run Shangri-La Hotels, and with a massive, massive background in running large-scale hotel chains. Welcome, sir, to this panel discussion. Next in line, Swami. Swami runs a destination management company in South India. He's a guru as far as South Indian landscape is concerned and experiences for guests are concerned. Swami, welcome to this panel discussion. We have Sanjay Basuji. Good evening and welcome to this session. Sanjay ji is a pioneer in Northeast travel. He's one of the pioneers for freshwater cruises in India and runs beautiful large ports. He's also a destination management company. He runs a destination management company in India and looks at the inbound segment in a large way, along with other DMCs like him. So I'd like to bring in Mr. Jamal. So we'd start with you for this discussion, and if you can have a few, over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good evening, Swami. Good evening, Sanjay. And thank you, Aditya, and a very warm hello to all our viewers. It's been a pleasure to be on this panel, and tourism and hospitality has always been very close to my heart. So it's hard to say no when people approach you and ask you, would you like to speak? Despite the fact it's a very, if I'm using that word, very morbid subject on Corona and COVID, which has been discussed and discussed and discussed over and over again for years, for months, sorry. And but still there's much to be done to see that the hospitality, travel industry, tourism industry makes a decent recovery in the foreseeable future. The world, of course, has never seen something like this, and I don't think so we will ever be prepared to deal with something of this scale. Is a disaster of a different kind, a natural disaster. If the health pandemics, of course, are always the most serious things when it comes to the travel tourism industry. And I know from my times during SARC times, and it was a very difficult time in Hong Kong and mainland China and even the Far East countries. Because when it comes to a pandemic of this nature, which is contagious, there's a fear psychosis that sets in the mind. And that's exactly what happened when COVID began late last year, I would say, November, December in mainland China. And thereafter, of course, it has spread to the world. It's history, actually. So fear of contracting this deadly disease or a virus and havoc it has caused to global economy, not just travel and tourism, but the global economy across the world is absolutely exceptional, I would say. One does remember in at least living memory something like this. We have seen 9/11, which was a very, very huge, what you call terrorist threat. And life changed. You know, the format of security changed, thinking of security changed. Whatever we did security before that had also almost become like redundant. And the new normal today is actually, one doesn't even think it came from 9/11. It just becomes part of your life in all spheres, whether it's airports, whether it's hotels, stores, malls, what have you. Every public space, literally. So I think a similar thing that's actually dawning on us and has dawned on us already. New normal is going to be something that is going to have enormous impact as far as putting together various initiatives that the countries are trying, nations are trying, India is trying to ensure that we are able to recover in decent time. What is the decent time? Is it 18 months? Is it 2 years? Is it 1 year? Is it 6 months? We don't know. And we all are waiting for the magic, so to say, if I may say, vaccine. And when that is going to come, we also don't know. See, one of the key factors, Aditya, about travel and tourism industry is because it's so dependent on as the word says, travel. And once travel stops, the entire industry comes to a standstill. And that's exactly what has happened now, because airlines stopped for months and they are back now in many parts of the world, whether they are forming those air bubbles and some agreement across government. And within the domestic, in India, of course, number of what you call flights have increased. And that is kind of given a bit of confidence in the mind of the traveler that you can go from point A to B. And with whatever messages that the airlines are giving today, as you know, the HEPA filters, and it is a very secure environment, and it is absolutely microorganism free. And the entire process of going into a plane and getting off, deplaning has been put to test, literally. So, but that's come out reasonably well, I would say. And the message today that we are saying is travel is reasonably safe. Having said that, I think still there is a lot of parts, many parts of the world, I would say, you're still have lots of restrictions and various independent, so to say, rules about quarantine, about various checks, etc., health checks, etc., that need to go, one has to go through. And you're still not very sure of say, if I may say that, you know, is that the right place to go? So I think the travelers today, if I may say that, the bucket list is completely being rewritten, and everybody's bucket list is going to be rewritten, because that whole concept of mass tourism or over tourism, as you call it, is possibly going to become the thing of the past. Today, I think people will look as I was listening to the panel before us, is experiential travel, whether it was in Madhya Pradesh or even elsewhere for that matter, is going to be experiential travel, and it's going to be small in nature. It may come at a price. I'm quite sure the price that we're going to pay is going to be reasonably higher than what the travelers are paying today. Because the experiential travel, the small travel, whether it's luxury, whether it's upscale, is going to come at a price, because the inventories are going to be smaller. And I think the experience is going to cost the traveler a little more than before. Having said that, I think there are a few things that I feel that we should see in the new normal is that hygiene and sanitation has become actually more of a, of course, is more of a, what can I say? It's like mandatory, it's a way of life. But having said that, I don't think so. Hygiene and sanitation can be marketed for you to attract what you call travelers, attract customers. I mean, imagine 9/11 happened, and you couldn't just market that as saying, you know, tiger toting guards standing there, and these are the security, you know, measures that we have taken. Similarly, I think the hotel industry, the travel and tourism industry has to underplay that and say that, you know, while you're taking all those measures of safety and security for the traveler, they must be underplayed without taking it lightly. They all have to be there, but I think the confidence has to be built in the traveler to say you should be able to travel safely and comfortably. The other point that I want to make is that is whole business of this recovery of regional regional effort or domestic tourism. I think that's one of the most important things that everybody has been talking about, and I think we've had endless discussions on this subject. But rightly so, because large countries like us in India, where there is a huge opportunity for us to explore the various destinations that possibly even I have not seen, and now they're all surfacing, whether it is in Maharashtra. Maharashtra is, of course, packaging many things for promoting tourism, domestic tourism, regional tourism, state tourism, and similarly for other states, etc. So I think to promote domestic tourism, I think, is going to be the key focus today, and leisure travel particularly, I think. I believe that leisure travel is going to recover far, far quicker than the business travel in the foreseeable future. Because from whatever reports that we get today, most leisure destinations are doing reasonably well. And this is not new. I'm just only repeating what you must have heard in the marketplace. But the fact is that there is a message there in to the fact that, you know, people are traveling for leisure destinations. People are tired of being in their homes for over 7 months, 8 months, and they're keen to go out with a breath of fresh air, go back to their favorite resorts, go back to new destinations possibly, which are drivable in some cases. And that is going to be that is already in demand. And I was listening to a particular panel just about a few weeks ago, and the gentleman on that panel from one company said they are actually sold out in October or November, fully sold out in November and December, which is very heartening to hear, because these are all homestays and small luxury resort, upscale resorts at various leisure destinations. And they are already looking very, very, the occupancies are looking very promising as they stand on books. Similarly, I think the leisure market in destinations that are closer to your country. For me, I mean, closest destinations are what? Sri Lanka, Maldives, Far East possibly. Once people get that confidence that those destinations are, they can go and they're safe to go there. It is a safe environment, and you can return if at all there is a situation which is creates a bit of an emergency. You can return. People will look for safe destinations where there is good healthcare, and also for them for their ability to return. And what kind of agreements that individual countries like ours has with various other countries in order to promote tourism, both inbound and outbound. India's outbound travel, as you know, has been over 25 million Indians used to travel out overseas. And can you imagine if we had to capture even a 50% number to begin with? I think we have a good home run. And that is possible, as I said earlier, because there are so many interesting places in this country, right from wildlife to heritage sites to various experiences, actually, right across from Jammu and Kashmir to Kanyakumari and from east to the west. I haven't seen the full of Northeast. How many people have seen the Northeast? It is the most beautiful part of this country, one of the most beautiful parts, scenic part of this country, with great amount of sightseeing and great amount of time with nature, literally, if I may use that word, time with nature. So I think these are the kind of things that are in the pipeline today. But I think as individuals, as people who are, we all leading our lives, I think we just need to have, I just feel that we are not living in isolation. So we are living in an interdependent world. And I think we just need to act more responsibly, whether it is a question of observing hygiene, whether it is a question of preserving environment. Environment, I think, is a very, very important thing. This has actually, we need to be grateful to Corona in some sense, because it has actually ignited the whole awareness for environment. The way the resources around the globe were depleted, and the way, and far faster than they can actually be replenished, is a cause of great concern globally. And I think that what has happened is, as a result of Corona, is that people are actually reflecting back to overconsumption. People are reflecting back as to kind of life they want to lead. People are reflecting back as to what are their real needs for having for being a happy individual, a happy family, happy community. And these are really, really important points. And Aditya, these are just my opening comments. So I hope I've not taken too much time.
Very well put, sir. Actually, I totally agree with you. And even with our previous panelist, Mr. Pardeshi, he was also putting forth his points that actually masks are more important than vaccines.
And absolutely right. I think we need to be responsible. You know, Aditya, that's one person can actually cause so much damage. Something of you can ignore. One person being careless is as serious as five people being careless or 100 people being careless, because this virus does not recognize what age group you are in, what kind of income group you come in, or which nationality you come in. It gets to you. It falls in love with you. You had it. Finished. So you have to be responsible. You have to be responsible.
Also, when we talk of sanitization and hygiene, I think that's a given in the hospitality industry, and it cannot be used as a marketing tool. You know, if you don't take care of sanitation and hygiene, you have no business to be part of hospitality.
Only thing is, what has happened is, Aditya, is that we have actually raised the bar of sanitation and hygiene. Sanitation and hygiene was always there. Today, to talk of a room being rested for 48 hours or thereabouts to be having the next customer come in, this is a different level of the sanitation hygiene we're talking about.
So that's a point that I want to get back to you on after we have a few panelists to speak to. Like you said, boutique properties will do very well. Experiential travel will do very well. And I think nobody does experiential travel better than Far Horizons and Mr. Sanjay Basu. And Mr. Basu, we'd like to hear what you have to say, exploring the lovely Northeast where you specialize in with your fantastic river cruises. And maybe we'd like to hear some, words of wisdom from you. Over to you, Mr. Basu.
Thank you, Aditya. Well, we have been all over the country. We've been in Kerala and Ladakh and Rajasthan and now Northeast. We've been an adventure travel company, a luxury travel company, and a cruise travel company. So it's been a few hacks. And as the senior vice president of the Adventure Tour Operators Association of India, nature is something that's very close. And that brings me to the lessons that actually we've learned from this COVID pandemic. In 38 years in this industry, you know, having seen terrorism and having seen wars, having seen riots, having seen various political disturbance situations and whatnot, without doubt, this has been the worst. Never was it that nothing happened. When 9/11 happened, Americans didn't travel, but the Europeans did. And when plague happened way back in early 90s, then the Europeans didn't travel, but the Americans still continued to travel. And of course, domestic built up. So this is the first time that something has happened where there's been an absolute full stop on the industry. I think the lesson that one learns is that in any business, there's always going to be three situations of survival, revival, and then growth. And if I was to elaborate on that, I'll start in the reverse. I'll take growth. Indian tourism today is standing at an inflection point. We need to rediscover ourselves. The old normal of promoting a handful of destinations has worked for a while. The Incredible India campaign was a beautiful campaign for the last two decades. But we really need to go beyond. We as a country need to stop thinking of ourselves as a Singapore or even a France. We really need to start thinking of ourselves as a subcontinent with a continent of experiences. Something like a UK to Ukraine and a Scandinavia to Spain. That is the scale of what we have to offer. And I think our, the trinity of product, price, and promotion leading ultimately to the end result of profit, it needs to be focused on how to make India be known as a destination which is a lifetime's journey. Possibly we have 4,000 destinations with 40,000 monuments, the fifth greatest natural heritage on earth, and the 10th greatest natural history on earth. These need to be brought out with a product development which focuses on bringing more than just the 20, 30 destinations or 40 destinations that the country is promoted. And in that, a lot of infrastructure development, accessibility, policy issues, all that needs to be addressed. So, just looking at adventure, because that is a subject that I deal with, and India's natural heritage, which I mentioned was the fifth greatest rated by the World Economic Forum, we are the only country in the world which has the largest number of 6,000 and 7,000 meter mountains, three types of deserts, the golden, silver, and the cold high altitude deserts, three types of forests, the equatorial rainforest, tropical rainforest, and alpine forests. Seven navigable rivers, 105 small and whitewater rivers, 7,000 kilometer coastline, and the largest coral islands on earth with a functional volcano there. And most of the world doesn't even know about this. Especially in today's time when pandemic situations are there, natural heritage is going to be the greatest escape for the world to go to. Coming to price, of course, we all know that we deal with a very high tax situation, and until unless the taxes come down to a single digit, we will not be able to compete on price. And then promotion. The Incredible India campaign needs to reinvent itself. I've been saying for a very long time that we need to come out with possibly 100 campaigns, with Incredible India campaign being as a mother campaign. And then there are baby campaigns, be it for nature, be it for adventure, be it for yoga, be it for Ayurveda, be it for cuisine, be it for textiles, be it for whatever. But we as a country, we as a destination, we need to put a few hundred destinations out there, a few hundred activities out there, and a few hundred attractions out there, so that the country is seen as a continent rather than as a country, a continent of experiences. From growth, I'll come to revival. I'm going a bit backwards on this flow of survival, revival, and growth. On revival, you know, we have to start thinking of 2021 and 2022 while we are still sitting in 2020. Because when the pandemic starts to ease up, hopefully the vaccine will be there by December. November, December is projected. And then a few hundred millions and a few billion doses will get made. India should be seen as that destination that everybody wants to go to. You know, here our nature is something that really needs to be promoted. Like I mentioned about the natural heritage and our wilderness, our wildlife is the greatest outside of the continent of Africa, which is again something that nobody in the world knows about. And in the revival process, where people will still have a hangover of the pandemic in their mind, if they know that we have such lovely, pristine, natural heritage, natural history destinations, which are naturally giving social distancing and are pandemic free, we might become a very, very attractive destination for the world to come to. But above everything else, I think we need to start doing forward planning and telling the world that be it from August 2021 or be it from October 2021, we are going to be ready to do business. We are going to be welcoming tourists from abroad, because in 2020 end, 2021 beginning, the professional tour operators sitting abroad will start planning their 21 winter, 22 spring season movement. And if they see a big padlock in front of India as far as visas is concerned, they will not look at India, but they will start looking at other destinations. And then if we do decide somewhere in July or August 21 that we are going to be open from October 21, the market would have already gone to wherever else it was supposed to, it wanted to go in the interim. So for the revival, I would feel that we really do need to start doing some forward planning, and we really need to start putting some messages in front of the world that we are going to be ready to do business post haste as soon as the situation is looking positive. And then coming to survival, I think what today the industry is definitely on its knees, you know, especially the inbound industry. The hotels are getting some business. Weekends are full in some places. Some places are doing okay. Some places are not doing okay. I today read a report that Delhi hotels are very low in occupancy, but some resorts in the remoter parts, which are within a driving distance from source domestic markets, you know, what we call the backyard travel, might have been doing okay enough to be able to survive. However, the tour operators are definitely not doing well, because they, you know, the tour operator service as such is something that the domestic market does not take. The domestic market tends to go and book resorts directly, and they go one-on-one with the resort and get into their car and drive to the resort and utilize the services there. The tour operators are completely left out. They have no business. They are not going to see any business for another 12 months. And, you know, it is being projected, as a member of, you know, even IATO, the community is almost talking that 70 to 80% of the tour operators of this country might actually go shut. And that is going to be very serious, because when the revival and the growth time comes, this is the army of sellers who walk the streets of the world, create that confidence in the market to bring the business in. So, you know, this industry, which was the first to be impacted, has been the highest to be impacted, the maximum to be impacted, and is going to be the longest to revive, needs a support to come in, you know, on a financial basis, be it more enhanced MSME loans through the MSME ministry, or be it the release of SEIS, which is the services export incentive scheme, which normally gets released by May or June. And today we are sitting in the month of November, coming to the month of November, and it has not been released at the time when we needed it the most. You know, these are things which are something that the government really needs to ponder on. So the entire combination of growth, revival, survival is very deeply linked. We as a country have come out with an objective of having 20, 30 million tourists coming to India. But if we don't take care of, apart from growth, along with survival and revival, we are going to be put back in that objective for the simple reason: if the industry is not impacted and the capacity is not there, then the process of revival is going to be slow, it's going to be delayed, and the growth that will follow will also be therefore slow and delayed, because the capacity of the professional industry, from the transfer executive to the owners of the companies, from the tour operators, the hotels, the people working in all these establishments, that as functional units needs to survive. And presently, most of the organizations have let go of a lot of their teams. So the capacity is already down by about 30%. It will, by the month of January, go down to about 60%. By the month of March, April, it'll go down to about 70 or 80%. And then when we see business come back from October 21, we might be down by 80 to 90%. So, it's something that is quite serious. But if we can get the survival, revival, and the growth put in place with a proper vision, plan, and resources, Indian tourism, which today clocked 9.2% of the GDP and 8.16% of employment, without this industry even being recognized as an industry, or with limitations on infrastructure, accessibility, and promotion being there, if all that can be rectified, I think we can, as an industry, easily leap over from 9.2% to over 20% of the GDP and deliver to this country industry where the employment has gone from 8.16% to about 16 or 18%. The GDP up by another 10 to 12% by this industry itself. There is a lot of potential. We have promoted ourselves as a limited destination with limited attractions, whereas we possibly are the world's only destination with unlimited attractions, unlimited potential. We have not even started to scratch the surface of the barrel till now. And at this moment, we are dangerously poised for a survival, revival, and growth to get set back by at least 2 to 3 years if proactive developments are not, and support are not, put in place. These are my some thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you. I think you've touched upon a whole range of issues here, very pertinent, but definitely important to re-beginning, this very industry. I think we also suffer from perception issue. We had a speaker from the United Nations in the previous session, and they suggested that over, less than 1% is our infection rate, whereas across the world, it's more than 2 to 3%. And they are going to put a paper across to present this very view. So I think when we talk of industries planning itineraries next year, this is one aspect which shows India as a very safe destination, not just the visas. This is also an important aspect that
Absolutely.
We need to touch upon.
I think India has done very well. On a per million basis, we are one of the lowest caseloads. We have one of the highest recovery rates, and we have one of the lowest mortality rates. This information is not known in the world. And there are various theories why we are doing so well. You know, might be our spices and our turmeric is doing really well for us. I think it's time for the world to convert to Indian food.
Possibly. And I think Indian food is incredibly popular also across the world right now. But also the other aspect you talk about is marketing and posturing ourselves and creating mini brands. So I think one is a perception issue. Second is marketing individual, verticals of tourism is also an important aspect. Maybe you're familiar with Eagle's Nest and, you know, what they have done as a community nature conservancy. So these could be new verticals. So when we try and reset and maybe, you know, solve a few of the problems within our industry and open up a larger market, new tourism destinations, new places where local communities benefit in a huge way could be also the way forward when we look at opening up new places across India.
So Aditya, we had actually made a proposal to the Ministry of Tourism and Ministry of Environment and Forests about opening the non-core zone areas in forests for conservancies, where tripartite projects can be made between the conservators, the local communities, and the eco-tour operators to have ecologists, small, sustainable, controlled, responsible ecologists within forest areas and unlock the fifth greatest natural heritage on earth, so that the tourists who would come into India to seek its wilderness were not in the day in the wilderness and in the night in a city. You know, to give them a 24-hour wilderness experience where the local community would be as involved with the ecotour operator and the conservator to make this happen. And in that situation, if the local community actually brings itself into these projects, starts contributing for a bigger share in the project, their subsistence farmlands, which can be then taken into private forestry, India's natural heritage will grow. Its forest coverage will grow. The objective of reaching 33% of the landmass as being covered by forests, whereas we've achieved only 24%, would be a painless, profitable process rather than the present painful, non-profitable process, be it by land acquisition or be it by the local community surrendering land without any mode to profit. So the whole conservancy model is something that's a win-win for the country overall.
So I think, you know, you're right, spreading the economic benefits of tourism across a wider landscape where communities benefit and microeconomies can become vibrant again is the way forward. And similarly, so with these views also, I'd like to come back to you on the conservancy part and some of the rebranding part of it later on in the session. I'd also like to bring in Swami from Dravidian Trails. Swami is, for me, he's my guru on South India, knows, most of the places like the back of his hand. And without much ado, I'd like to bring him onto the session. Swami, over to you.
Yeah. Good evening, everybody. And it was nice listening to both these panelists. Thank you, Aditya. What Sanjay Basu has spoken, I'm also a tour operator. I have to take a deep breath, before I start. See, there is a book called Future Shocks. It is written by the most famous futurist, Mr. Alvin Toffler, in 1970. In this, regarding the future shocks, he describes future shock as the certain psychological state of individuals as well as society. Or let's say, to make it in a very simple definition, too much changes in too short a time. Yes, the $1 million, $1 billion stories of tourism, highest footfall in destinations, and then it is the amount which is contributed towards the development of the economy and to the country. All these statistics has become the glory of the past, but it has given strength and it has also given courage to us. So what we have learned or learned from this current crisis, I'm going to share in a three part. One, as an entrepreneur. Second, I will do as a tourism professional. And third, as an individual. As an entrepreneur, this could be applicable to tourism and in general also is what I felt. Although tourism in every industry is, for example, has taken a beat worldwide and which is well known. So the first thing is, whenever you do business, we always say, be sure nothing goes wrong, something may go wrong, you have to be proactive, be ready for the difficult times. But nobody would have anticipated before this crisis that the worst will come. So ideally, I think it is good, you have to be prepared for the worst, even when your business is doing glory. So that's the first learning, I would say, as an entrepreneur for me. I think most of us will agree with that. And second, if you ask me, unprecedented or unexpected financial, can we say crisis? Yes, financial crisis or crunch will come. This is also something which is unexpected when everything goes well. That's also the most important. And then we have to find a way of saving so that to run the organization to the maximum extent. And also even during difficult times, it supports. So the saving is also very important. I mean, further level, when you see the worst and too much crisis in finance, that level savings which I'm talking to you. And also then there is a need to equip in implementing mechanization or better software, digitalizations, focus oriented human resources. So this is also important. Then we also know from this current crisis that nature can turn all our calculation irrespective of our experiences. So that also will help you to be ready that one day you will become nothing, your knowledge, your money, everything goes off. So be prepared for this. And then it is also, I felt, I think, especially we being maybe a small team, but generally I found to have an understanding and reinventing or reciprocating colleagues with you in your team. That will always help you to manage and overcome many crises, including this is what I feel. And the most important, always diversifying is always better. Like the economic experts' view, it's a disadvantage to have all your apple in one basket. So as an entrepreneur, expect the worst. I think this is the first time we talk about expecting the worst. Taking risk will let you down, all those things, but expect the worst, both in terms of your running and both in terms of your financial, and still try to save money. So this is the new norm or the new way which you have to think. That is what I would say as an entrepreneur. Now coming as a tourism professional. Okay, uncertainty in your business. I think for us, as Sanjay has clearly said, it's little longer going to be. It's going to be, much, much different than all others. So uncertainty in the business is the major one which you have to know. And then changes in priorities. Of course, change in the trade is happening, as Mr. Bharat Jamal was explaining. Everybody knows, too many changes are happening in the industry. Then this was already there, but still it has become more important that you have to see product formation. That means we are always doing most of the time product based on the need of a customer. But now in every point, you have to focus it much more. That's the point. Now I would say the another most important as an entrepreneur, I think, is everyone will agree, anybody does business, especially in tourism and hospitality industry, creating a wow factor in each level is very important. But at the same time, I would rephrase this as we have to recheck, because I don't want to say that we will do or the society will do, but we have to, create ourselves to this forum that making regular as exceptionally outstanding. When I wrote this statement, I was just thinking, when I say what will be, even for example, we know, sanitizer when we are giving, I said, okay, our drivers may be having a gloves and then new gloves and give it to sanitizer, because this is the big thought process. We have to, simply, every regular should be extraordinarily outstanding. So that is one way which is to be as a tourism everything. And then, now it has become very relevant that you have to be in a way as a professional. What I'm going to do or what we are going to do, that we will have to go sit and analysis. But we have to make in a way that we are essential in the industry. Although you said we are now talking about industry itself is essential with so much changes in the globe is happening. That is the first level. The moment industry is able to survive, then we have to make sure that we are essential to the industry. So I said as an entrepreneur, then I said as an individual, as an tourism professional. Now I come as an individual. I think, you know, time for self-evaluation, quality as well as quantitative self-analysis of life. And I would first say the most important today, everyone will agree, because in spite of having so many problems in tourism, many, we are all happy that we are living healthy. So health will be the number one. And second point, I would like to re-endorse what Mr. Jamal said, that keeping your health was previously necessary. But today, keeping your health is mandatory because you are responsible for the society. So you are inconvenience and cause inconvenience to someone. You know, so you are, it is very important that keeping your health for yourself, one for the society, it is very, very important. So that is the first thing which I would do and must do. What are the necessary to be done, we will be doing it. And then we also realize that we can be such a long time at home. You know, okay, sometime we were made to stay at home, but nevertheless, even if you leave 50-60% of it, still we stayed 30-40% more at home. So which means by staying at home, whatever small things can also give happiness and do that. So we have to revolve in a way that you find a time for yourself and do those things which is needed. Then, see, also another important, we are talking about health, then automatically comes social distancing. So I would always say the social distancing today is mandatory, but at the same time, how are you going to maintain your relationship with your people? This is going to help you both personally as well as professionally. Because this is where the strength of an every organization individual will come back. So it is important that you maintain your relationship, which is there with both personal as well as professional. That is what I would say. And then whatever the commitments you have, whatever the responsibilities you have, that you need to finish. Now comes, how will I meet both my ends as a personal and a personal after priority? What will be the way you will overcome the difficulties you face when you have revenue, no revenue or less revenue? And then also income is also accordingly, revenue and income both is low. One is you have to do a tight, very tight budgeting. And then secondly, I'm sure panelists and most of the audience will agree, whatever we felt was necessary or whatever we felt is inevitable to, we must have, today we feel it's not necessary. So better instead of getting it from this pandemic learning, it is before itself we replan that whatever is definitely necessary, go for it, otherwise save your money. That is the thing which I would say. Then when you come, of course, now I think technology has been doing very well. So we have to see how we can cope up with the current, explore the opportunities in the web, virtual world. That is number one. Then e-learning has become very important in all the process. And you know, this entrepreneur, individuals, and as well as tourism professionals, all these, if you combine and you want me to say in a one simple lesson, I think support each other. That has been the biggest learning now. Support each other has been the biggest learning. Then I will also say, I think, I don't know, it is very, very harsh, but today I would say this is what is becoming. Capability has become very important than the capability today. You know, you need to adapt to the changes. You need to accept there are many difficulties are there. You need to go with the flow which is going now. So those things has become very important. Some will, it's very sad to say that some will perish, some will struggle, but those who can adapt capability will be able to definitely come in the category of success category. This is what I would ideally say. So for me to take is, lot of difficulties, lot of problems, but there is always a light somewhere. So to find that light, we have to survive. And then simple, maintain your relationship and then support each other. And then see how you develop your relationship, which will help you for personal and professional. Then see what is happening in the market, how as a post-professional you become essential in the trade. You know, they should invite you. So these are the main points which I would like to cover and say these are our learning. Yes, implementation, there'll be some modification, but you have to go with what is happening. And that is what I would say. And now, as you rightly said, now inbound is suffering, so people are all, everybody is going into domestic market, because now people know that the international flights are not there. So including us, have jumped into domestic market. But how we do? So we thought the current team is equipped only for being operations. So we need to have a qualified person to look after. But do you ask, then it is a question of investing money. These challenges and thought processes come. But one thing is very clear. I think at least for people of my age and above, I don't foresee, God willing, another such a disaster in our life. So if you are able to manage for other 18 months or 20 months, I think then there is glory definitely waiting, and hope dies lost. So let's live with the hope. I think I make some sense. Thank you very much, Aditya. Thank you.
Thank you, Pami. Very well put. Yes, there's definitely hope, but as Sanjay was saying earlier, you guys are the warriors that walk the streets of the world and bring in, valuable inbound tourists into India. How do you see yourself sell India better in the coming probably second half of next year? Knowing that, a lot of the itineraries will probably be planned now for the next 18 months.
See, just to share this, I'm not trying to isolate one particular state. We had the same discussion. So during that time, as you rightly said, I think the burst, there is always a feeling in the so-called the bigger world that still health is an issue in India. You still feel that when anything comes to health, there's a problem that, even people, some of our good overseas partners say, you are used to different kind of air. That's why we are having problem. As if it indirectly means that we have better resistance power than them because our air is not good air. That is our strength. Why should we worry? That's our strength. So as you rightly said, it is going to be definitely difficult, and thousands of questions will be asked, and it will be compared to many different countries. They'll say, automatically they'll pick up, see Sri Lanka, very nice, see Maldives, see all those things. India is unique in its own level. So when we go there, currently if you ask me what strategy we have, we'll go back and say, boss, all these points, we had number of cases very less, hygiene was very good. People have also learned how to be hygiene was always there, but it has to be better maintained, how it is there. Then we will also share what training we have given to our drivers, what's the our field people, what kind of training we have done, which kind of hotel, what they have done. So we go back combinedly with all the best things, what they have done, go and present it. Then they will make you a different question. That is where I said you have to make yourself adaptable for the change of need of a customer, which is totally maybe new. Because all our so many years of experience, is it worth now if you ask me? That gives you a confidence because you have been to those countries, you have met those people. The only advantage we have today, everybody is starting from the scratch. The greatest advantage is we have customers. When you start new, you don't have customers. You have to acquire customers. So now at least we have overseas partners. If they are able to acquire customer, it will be helped. So the more you go and meet them, they will keep on giving you various inputs of different countries. By that, we have to adapt. Okay, we have our own USPs, but certain things we have to adapt need based on the global requirement. So that's what I would say. Currently, one particular formula is that as a country, we have done well. Overall, we have done well. Yes, there is always many other points, but in general, we have done well. Let's go with pride. Tell them what we have done. Then we will see what happens.
Thank you, Swami. Thank you. So with that, Sanjay, I'd like to come back to you. And, Swami is very pragmatic about selling India to the world. And you were saying that, marketing is something that we need to look at. So how would you rebrand yourself with your current customers or with new customers? And how would you sell India better?
Aditya, for myself, we have focused a lot on India's nature, and it has shown to be an approach which has brought a lot of resonance. Because in the pandemic conditions and post-pandemic conditions, people will be looking at nature-oriented destinations, as one can even see in the domestic movement that's happening right now. The small lodges in the little more remoter parts of the country, which are within a driving distance, are doing well. Whereas big cities, townships are not doing that well as far as hotels are concerned. So, you know, we have been focusing a lot on nature. As an organization, we are in the mountains, in the deserts, in the rivers, and in the forests. And like I mentioned, you know, that was one of the greatest unpromoted major asset of this country, which the world is not aware of. You know, the world, like I mentioned, is not aware that 70% of the Himalayas is in India. When an average European or a Japanese or an American thinks of Himalayas, he thinks of Nepal or might be Bhutan. You know, whereas we have 70% of it. So that is one big gap that needs to be filled up with both infrastructure development, accessibility development, policy rectification of opening up the restricted portions. Because, you know, 80% of our natural heritage is locked up by the forest laws of this country. You know, then you come to, like I said, the deserts. You know, we are the world's only country with three kinds of deserts. You know, forests and rivers and coastline and seas and oceans and coral islands and volcanoes. So, in the revival process, like I'd mentioned, I feel India needs to project its pristine natural heritage in a very strong manner, because that is where the world will be wanting to go. And if we can project the fact that we are the fifth greatest natural heritage on earth, with all these great attractions of nature, you know, the 1.3 billion people, 22 million city, you know, population cities, will be things that the world will not get reticent due to, but will say, oh, okay, I land, I go straight into the forests, into the deserts and the mountains, and I'm away from the maddening crowds, and I'm in the midst of nature with an adventure, activities, eco attractions, all that, and I can get away to a, you know, a unique culture, unique country, because each of our natural heritage has unique cultures there too. So, you know, we really need to do that projection. The long-term impact of something like that will be that India's natural history will not be just a tiger, and its natural heritage will also not be just a tiger, but really everything that we have to offer, which is, you know, the fifth greatest. So that is that's one aspect. You know, there are simple messages that the world doesn't realize, that our culture is the only surviving pre-Bronze Age and Bronze Age culture on the face of this earth. So our entire marketing that needs to be done has to stop, like I said, stop thinking like a Singapore or even a France, but start thinking like from UK to Ukraine and Scandinavia to Spain. We really need to start thinking like a continent. We need to project ourselves as an experience of continents. And then we need to garner the business that would be equivalent to that what a continent would garner. I think we need to stop thinking small first and foremost.
I think that's very well put. I think, you know, the Incredible India campaign has been very successful. But like all things successful, there needs to be an evolution. And that evolution is, I think, this is the right time to evolve. Maybe multi-brands for different verticals is what can be considered. But do you feel that we suffer from a high amount of perception issues, like you said, either Himalayas, or it is safety, or to some extent it is even food, you know, or it is, you know, the population of the country. So there is a perception problem about India that we still have not addressed as yet. And I think the new campaigns should definitely solve these perception issues going forward. And this is the right time to do it, I feel.
Absolutely. I think the broader the basket of attractions we offer, the more comprehensive our attractions are put in front of the world, that itself will start addressing a lot of the perception problems. When they think that we are the most crowded country on earth and they see our pristine nature, they will realize that we have crowds, but we also have those you know, remote pristine areas, when we start projecting our food, you know, I think it's time to talk about the fact that possibly our food has saved us in this pandemic with some of the best statistics. Yeah, you know, the world is today eating turmeric. So they better start eating all the other spices also that we use in our cuisines. So there is so much messaging that we need to do. No single campaign is ever going to do justice to the extent of the million messages that we need to put out in front of the world. You know, India has what is there throughout the North Americas and the Latin Americas and the Africas and the Europes and the Asias all combined in one small country or one pretty big country. So we really need to make the world understand that we have something for everybody. But just saying that we have something for everybody is not enough. We really need to put the basket of our everything out there very prominently. Let there be a cuisine promotion, a nature promotion, an adventure promotion, a cruise promotion, promotion for textiles, our 40,000 monuments, for everything possible. So this messaging needs to be re-evolved completely. I think our messaging at the moment is, it was great for the period when it was set, but now it is way lacking. At this point.
Yeah. Thank you. Raju, would you like to add something to this?
Yeah. No, I have quite a few comments to make. First and foremost, I think we need to just internalize the issue of tourism very deeply. I know my friend Sanjay has spoken a lot about what we have to offer, and I completely agree with him. So did Swami say this. We don't ever ask the question why people are not visiting our country. Why are we having only 10 million tourists so far? Why if the local Indian doesn't want to travel within India and wants to go overseas? Marketing is a very important part. To me, the most important part is experience, physical convenience. I think that's the most important part. How do you get to a destination X or Y, whether it's a hill station, whether it's a forest, whether it is a heritage monument, etc., and what do you find there eventually? How do you improve that experience? What kind of partnership we have with what we call the PPP to improve that whole infrastructure and the whole visit experience? People must enjoy. You know, we are in the business of providing that pleasure and joy. There's a difference in mystique and misery. You know, people confuse. We confuse ourselves in mystique and misery. Mystique and misery are two different things. अरे ऐसा ही होना चाहिए ऐसा ही रहना चाहिए ऐसा नहीं रहना चाहिए गॉड डजंट वांट अस टू बी लाइक दिस गॉड वांट्स अस टू बी कंट्री टू बी क्लीन द बिगेस्ट इश्यू इज क्लीनलीनेस इवन कोविड डजंट लाइक इट दे आर आल्सो सेइंग दैट पोल्यूशन इज द बिग बिग एनिमी एज फार एज कोविड रिकवरी इज कंसर्न सो वेयर इज इट व्हाट आर वी टॉकिंग अबाउट द क्लीनेस्ट एयर व्हाट आर वी टॉकिंग अबाउट द बेस्ट रोड ट्रांसपोर्ट व्हाट आर वी टॉकिंग अबाउट बेस्ट अराइवल एक्सपीरियंस वी आर प्राउड ऑफ दीज एयरपोर्ट्स what we have been able to achieve in the last 8-10 years, if you had told somebody 15 years ago, we will have these airports, you'll say, please examine your head. You know, it's not possible. But we have managed to do it, right? Because there was a will, there was an intention, we have done it. But that is only one point of tourism, which has actually become absolutely world-class. But I think the other points of tourism, as my friend Sanjay was talking, is we must ensure that the last mile connectivity to these destinations has to be absolutely outstanding. Because otherwise, you know, we can say our domestic tourism will grow and we will go, we will travel. Why do you think people have not traveled? We must ask this question to ourselves. Is because getting to a point A to a very, very world-class UNESCO site is a challenge. And we must accept that. And we have to work towards improving that experience. Marketing is, people already know India extremely well because of our rich heritage and culture, etc. I think it's been talked about endlessly and will continue to be spoken about because nobody has what we have. But I think what is important is when you come here, what do you experience? Do we experience a clean nation, an experience which is absolutely an honest experience, you know, right from the time you arrive to the time you leave, okay? Every tourist is your ambassador. When he goes back, he doesn't need marketing. When you go back and you tell 15 other people, you already created a chain of more customers in the future. I think that's a very, very important factor. Now, how their experience is going to improve, I know the government has to work closely, has to invest in many destinations. Why do you think people go to Masai Mara or Kenya, right? It's an experience. It is not only the abundant wildlife that is there, which is rare to see, but it's the whole experience that they have packaged. Kenya has managed to package. And it's a similar thing in our country. I think some places we have done exceedingly well. And I know in Karnataka, we have done very well. Sanjay, you will agree with me. And many other destinations where the reserve forests are there, reserve sanctuaries are there, we have done very well. But not in all places, we have done exceedingly well. When I hear that 60,000 tourists have arrived downed in Simla on one weekend, I get worried about environment. I'm worried about the impact on the environment. What is this? Is it? Why this craziness is gone completely? Are you going to demolish that place for good? This is the responsibility of people. My point here is that every destination like Bhutan has done, it has a very controlled way of saying tourism. It's going to be controlled. You cannot have X amount of zillions of people coming in one place. It's not possible. You're going to disturb the environment. And that's what we've done over the years. So I think that's about my comments as far as the improving experience is concerned. The other point that I want, two points that I want to also say quickly, because I think I need to respect time, is that, the market future, the future market will remember how companies have handled their customers during the COVID time. Whether it is the way they've handled their bookings, whether they've handled refunds, whether they've handled the credit business properly, or they've just done, a reactive crisis management, and they have placed their own assets above the customers' rights or the guests' rights, really. There are lots of companies who possibly need to learn that, because this is the time to earn that respect of the market, not just in India, globally. I think those companies will have an opportunity to really build a strong reputation by being empathetic, by being absolutely accurate in their information and sharing what is the truth that is there for the customers. I think that's very, very important. Point number two that I want to say is that I know I did mention this earlier, is that this new protocols of COVID-19 are here to stay. This is not going to go away. This is going to stay, whether you have a vaccine, whether you have a cure, whether you have medication, etc. But this is not going away in a hurry. So I think it's important to accept that these COVID-19 protocols, health protocols and hygiene are here to stay. And we will continue to make sure that, as a country, we must showcase. And I think lots of hotel, especially in the hospitality industry, in the travel industry, we are already observing it. But I think it is important to see that, that is a sustained effort even post-COVID. And it will be a sustained effort post-COVID, because it's not going away in a hurry. This is not going away in a hurry. So I think these are two points that I wanted to add that to what Sanjay has already said.
Yes, Swami.
Yeah, I actually was thinking, we also have one, which is our strength. People come to India largely for the way of life of our country, how the people are. They come to explore, they want to see the rickshawala, they want to go. So how are we going to manage their experience? Because, okay, maybe we go back to some customers will come on arrival from the airport, go back to the hotel, see some attractions and go back. But in general, we are also here to give local experience. Already, we are also talking with the responsible tourism in Kerala, which is very famous. So there is what kind of a protocol we can give. That is one great challenge we have to handle it, because that is our strength. Because interacting and coordinating with people is our strength. So that is one point which is. And as he rightly said, I think accessibility, attraction, accommodation. These 3A has to be handled very well. And we have gone very big, we have grown. So we have to see how we handle it. And as you said, carrying capacity of a destination is a problem in our country. So that needs to be addressed. And let's see, the more we go, it has to be done. I think we never know, so much wildlife is available everywhere. It has all come out. So these are many challenges which is there. But I think we will overcome and we will have to overcome. Thank you.
You know, the Prime Minister started this. So Aditya, one point. The Prime Minister started the Swachh Bharat campaign. I think this is the most integral part for tourism. That campaign is actually, what can I say, the most needed campaign. And I think we have made some progress on that front. I'm not saying we've made leaps and bounds, but I think we've made progress. Like a gentleman from Indore was talking, the clean cities that they have, they're very proud of those, Indore and several other cities which are very, very clean. And they are examples of this. They're shining examples of this. So I think that Swachh Bharat is actually so important for tourism, and more emphasis and more money we can put in Swachh Bharat, and more role that the private sector can play in this to ensure that, you know, we are able to showcase the country in a cleaner and in a more safe and hygienic manner, so to say. But, you know, that will be a very important driving factor for tourism.
So I think some of the key takeaways that we look at, I think on the policy side, I think land use policy, you know, and that is something that Farhat, you've touched upon. You don't want to make another Shimla or another Mahabaleshwar of these places. So I think from the government perspective, land use policy is a huge part and parcel of tourism, just like cleanliness is or hygiene is. And, you know, like Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is kind of, you know, the umbrella organization under which a lot of this might, you know, come across well. Secondly, we are dealing actually with two different segments of people here. We are looking at a mass tourism. You know, a lot of domestic tourism is often mass tourism. We would need to have mass tourism places which are having the carrying capacity to cater to maybe a few thousand people per day. Possibly these could be, around areas where there is enough market to drive this kind of volume. Second is, we are also looking at mature travelers who are looking at an experienced product. Experienced product, these are the people who've now seen the world, traveled across everywhere, but are looking inwards into India now. And I think this experience-based tourism, which is for the more mature traveler, is what a lot of people cater to here. I know Sanjay and Swami, you guys do. But even Farhat, your hospitality chain, you know, considering the restrictions that you have and the kind of inventory that you run, you know, I think even the hotel experience has been redefined quite a bit as far as... especially the food. And I think that is a key driving force, you know, not just now, but even in the foreseeable future. We have also Reema Lokesh here, and Reema is a very senior journalist, I would like to bring her on the panel just for a quick moment so that we would like to hear her out. Reema, over to you. Can you just switch on your mic, please?
Aditya, thank you so much. I think we've crossed the 7 o'clock deadline like Cinderella. But I think this Cinderella is not in a rush because she's already found her prince. So I can wait a little longer.
How are you, Reema?
Hello, Reema.
Good evening. Good evening. Hi. Such an August panel. Thank you so much. Most of you all are my friends. So, but as I'm saying, Roshani, do I have to bring you in or can I just wind up? Or what is it?
Please, Shani.
Can I continue? All right. So, Roshali, do I have like exactly 5 minutes, right? Because we have to respect.
Yes, you can. Yes. You have 5 minutes.
Yes. Beautiful. Of course, we have a session tomorrow again, but there's one thing I want to just say in this whole 3 beautiful hours that we spent just exchanging life with each other. I firmly feel that responsible and sustainable tourism today is not an option anymore, but is a serious option. If we don't get it right, come on, we are finished. And if not now, then when? Because COVID did its job. COVID seriously showed us the mirror. And if you're going to stand and just stare at that mirror, I think we all as an industry have failed. Every stakeholder here, I mean, I love what Mr. Farhat said. Sanjay, of course, has been so passionate about the mountains. He spoke about getting continents. It's like India has a continent, and let's speak about that. Serious issues like carrying capacity needs to be respected, because what happened with Ladakh after 3 idiots, we don't want to all be idiots. We need to really respect carrying capacity, as Aditya clearly says, that it's all about the mature traveler. It's using your land use policy rightly. And also what Mrs. Swaminathan said, pragmatic and extremely practical. He said it's important for the A's, the 3 A's, which is attraction, accessibility, and activities. So true. He brought us down to ground zero saying, guys, we are all in it together, but let's be real. Farhad has this passion. I mean, we've heard him all through his journey at the Taj, one of the stalwarts of the Indian hospitality industry, said about mysticism and misery. Farhad brought the spiritual angle in it. And yes, Farhad, really by the end of the journey, COVID has made us all introspectors, 100%. Let me get on from the last session hitting on straight to my first session. Roshali, I want to say you're beautiful because you brought in the moment, the tempo, the mood to the whole experience. Thank you, Roshali. You've been so, I know because you related to art and spirituality, it reflects in your personality and in your face. Leela Lad, one of the most beautiful leaders that the government ever had and has. Of course, she's moved out from an official position, but her welcome note, her address was very clear that to rejuvenate, reunite together. It's a journey that we all take together. We can't say in isolation, your hospitality, your tourism, or your aviation, forget it. Your ground handler, come on, it's gone. Those days are gone. That's why I keep saying PPP, the famous public-private partnership model we all speak about, cannot be a paper tiger anymore. Aditya, you relate to the tigers. You want the tiger as ferocious, my friend. Because I remember years ago when we wrote about Taroba and your experience, you know what it is to be having paper tiger policies, right, Aditya? So it's so important to walk that talk. And it's so important to get everyone in it together because we don't want, there's no time for conversational action anymore. It will only lead to inaction. Sanjay will agree, conference after conventions, we are only speaking for the past 23 years. Kuch karo par kab? Nahi to kabhi nahi. Literally, guys, please, I mean, due respect to everybody. But I'm just passionate about this one thing that we can't take this thing for granted anymore. We move on straight to Mr. Gautam Desai Ji. He set the tone of what India was through the thousands, through the, we got onto a journey to say only 1% is what we go to the gym. I mean, he literally told us, excuse me, wake up, guys. He said to you very clearly also that travelers became conquerors because India was so damn attractive. She has music, culture, art, architecture. Of course, she has it all. But she also has one thing, what Mr. Gaurang said, is the grassroots, the sustainable and responsible tourism, which this beautiful company called Govardhan Eco Village is actually putting forth in all honesty. Most importantly, what Mr. Gaurang Desai Ji brought in was, Dasji brought in was, the importance of soft power. I don't know whether you all missed that, but he said something like, sell your soft power, India, which is values, wisdom, culture, and tradition. And he said, zone in on that uniqueness and on that advantage. Amazing gentleman, amazing personality who walks the talk and who actually builds this whole foundation called sustainable and responsible tourism. We moved on straight into Mr. Mafatlal's words, the chairman of the group of one of the most respected of India, and he spoke about the village. I mean, a man as high flying and probably in the best hotels of the world says to you, get to your roots, get to milking your cows, get to being those happy cows. He said that the cows there are so happy. And what we're seeking after COVID-19 is just pure happiness. Let me be honest, I thank COVID because my spouse, me, my two bachas, my two girls, finally enjoyed each other in all honesty. Okay, let me be honest, my husband will happily fight also, but that fight is with so much of fun. My daughters are with it, so COVID gave us happiness. And this happiness is exactly what Mr. Dasji was saying, that, you know, we all need to be like those happy cows, honestly. And I'm happy being a happy cow. We moved to a very practical story with Mrs. Meenakshi Sharma. She is one of the most respected names in the tourism space today. And as Mr. Mafatlal said, he was very happy to hear what she said. She said, domestic tourism is the way forward. And 18 years of my journalism, I'm saying this one thing, that India tourism's mainstay is domestic tourism. Guys, don't forget it. It's your wealth, And it's wise for you to know that. What Sanjay is saying, the mountains, the rivers, you've got the coastal regions of India. Come on, why don't we just tell our kids, go enjoy this. You don't necessarily have to go to the Masai Mara. Of course, it's beautiful. But trust me, my experience of the Kaziranga National Park, personally, was a game changer for me. Sanjay Bansu, thank you, because I was your speaker at the ADTOI conference in Guwahati. You, ADTOI and that team took me to Kaziranga and showed me what India's Kaziranga is all about. I'm dying for my girls to go there. In 3 kilometers in the Buhapahar range, you get 58 species of birds. I mean, what are we talking about? So really, eye-openers at every juncture of your life. Going on to Mr. Pardesi, oh my God, Praveen Pardesi, sir, opened our eyes to something called transformational tourism. That man said something very clear. One, great farming, everything perfect. But do you realize there's something called biodiversity? He said, bring in wildlife, just bring in your friends back, clearly. Transformational tourism, he said. That's something extremely critical here, which not many people speak about. So Mr. Pardesi had statistics number one. He had a very clear presentation number two. And number three, the gentleman gave you hard facts. He said three things was, mask penlo, otherwise it's not happening. Social distancing and certain protocol that every resort has to follow. Cleanliness, hygiene. Honestly, my mother, if I'm going to take my two girls out on a vacation, first thing, forget the glamour. I'm looking at genuine hygiene. Are my kids going to be safe? Let's be realistic. Are my kids going to be safe? The call of every traveler today. I'm forgetting them. I'm not interested in having the most beautiful linen on that bed. I only want to know whether that linen is hygienic enough for my kids to sleep on it. Very clearly. As we moved on, he was very, very realistic. He brought in the story of literally getting into the zone of telling people certifications are critical and take care to move in from your farming to biodiversity. And he said that, you know, literally the forest people are all out of it. You're from fuel cooking to LPG, the tigers have helped them earn it. Aditya said your tigers have helped them earn it. So that was a very beautiful statement he made. The tigers give you money. So hang on to get them in, get the tigers back in. We moved on to Mr. Barot. I was not surprised. He has been passionately supporting Indian hospitality industries, for instance, over 3 decades now. About realistics, he spoke about policies, he spoke about the issues that the hospitality industry, the restaurant owners are facing, and he's only hoping against hope. Every time he says that the government looks at us more fondly because we are good people. He always says that we are good people, don't shun us. We give you food by the end of it. So, you know, give us enough respect. He also spoke about how mice are suffering. Mice as a business is suffering for sure. And it will take a little time to pick up, which he's being realistic about. We came on to Mr. Yuvraj, one of the finest tourism authorities in our country today. And Madhya Pradesh has always been a game changer. That state, which doesn't have tea in the center of India, got the formula right in many places. And as Leela Latkur rightly said, Madhya Pradesh has always been a step ahead. And he said very, very clearly that we are talking about our cities. We are talking about Indore being the food tourism hub. We are talking about Gwalior being the city of music. He said Orchha being an international, positively beautiful destination. He spoke about activity-based tourism and tourism for the families. He said, time and again, we are always going to speak vocal for local. Yes, that's Madhya Pradesh's USP because it's always been trying to get rooted. It spoke about the importance of, you know, tourism to the roots, to the grassroots. There are Chanderis, there are Maheshwaris. I mean, personally, I'm a Sari person. I think it's such a wealth there to talk about India's textile tourism, probably also. We moved on to this beautiful panel, which I started with some. But the fact remains, Aditya, you said something extremely critical by the end of the journey, that it's all about awakening. It's all about having maturity in yourself when you're a traveler today. We cannot be irresponsible travelers anymore. We are done being irresponsible. I have to teach generation next that even that little Lay's ka chips ka packet, wo kachre mein dalo, please. It's like the small little things. I mean, that can only come by telling your children, be responsible, be respectful, and most importantly, be resilient. This is the 3 R's. Because I believe I'm remarkable, I'm also an R, and the 3 R's are resilience, responsibility, and respect. On this note, I've finished my 5 minutes. I respect time every time. And we have shot this discussion by just 18 minutes, but that 18 minutes was pure discussion. Thank you so much. Over to you, Aditya. Over to you, Vrishali. Thank you for the opportunity. And we will meet again tomorrow, better, brighter. Thank you.
Thank you, Reema, for summing up the day. Thank you for all the panelists, Sanjay, Swami, and Faraji. Thank you for your time. For tomorrow, again, Reema, we have you, and you have a whole session to yourself. I know you need a lot of time to speak because you have so much knowledge to share. After that, we have Gauranga Prabhuji, who talks about sustainability. Then we have Zelan Prabhal, who talks about domestic tourism. She's the owner of KC Tourism Palace. They are one of the leaders of domestic tourism as well as outdoor. Then we have a very interesting panel discussion tomorrow on financial sustainability, where we have Mrs. Rubinder Bra from Incredible India. We have the Vice President of IDBI Bank, and we have a private equity fund called Basic Partner. So that will be a very interesting session on financial sustainability within the tourism industry. And we are touching about hotels, we're talking about inbound operators, we're talking about itinerary, we're talking about experiences on that session. Next, lastly, we have a session on sustainability in tourism, where we again touch upon things like land use policy. A lot of the things that Sanjay wanted to touch upon. And we've got Julian Matthews from Top Tigers, we've got Michael Dominic from CGH, and we've got Mr. Venkatesan from Incredible India. So that's a big day for us tomorrow as well. So stay tuned tomorrow as well. And hope you have a good evening. And thank you for your time and good night.
Thank you, Aditya. Thank you, Vrishali. Thank you, Reema. Lovely to see you. And thank you, Tommy and Sanjay. Great to see you both. And lovely to be with you more than anything else. All of you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Have a great evening, guys. Thank you. Stay safe and stay well.
Tomorrow. Thank you.
Bye.